If you like this video, make sure to subscribe to our channel and hit the notification bell icon to get the latest updates.
Okay, I think I'll get started. It's almost 7 of them are there. Not bother much about the remaining 3. Let me just anyone attempted for any exercise? Did you guys tried 1, 2, 3, 4 exercise numbers?
Yeah, Rajan, as I said yesterday, I think the exercises that's there in the LMS, the SharePoint, they are different than what you had shown.
They didn't share the ones which I shared with them was not shared to you guys.
List I didn't receive.
Hey, who's there? I think Akash is not there today, right? May I know who's there, the organizer? ZaranTech? Nobody there. Okay. Were you guys checking? I think.
You want me to share my screen?
Yeah. Go ahead and share your screen.
Sure.
I did some rearrangement, you know, for the training module. So the ones which I am presenting, pretty much equivalent of it, you've been seeing the training content.
Yeah, content. Yeah, even the content is different, but yeah, I'm sharing my screen.
So the critical things for you guys are the recordings, okay? And then let me see full screen, okay? This is what they share, labs, patient PPT.
So this assessments, and let me go to the labs.
No, I think you modified yesterday.
No, it's the old one.
Oh yeah, okay. I think about 6 days ago, right? Okay.
Yeah, as I said, even the session PPTs are different.
Session PPTs are different for sure. Yeah. These things are the one which is shared to you guys, right? Okay. But I have modified in the trainer PPT. Maybe I will ask them to share those PPTs. But anyways, you know, the one which I'm sharing, I'm using it for all purpose, you know, even for SAP trainings also. That's sort of proprietary only. But the equivalent of it, you'd be getting it for sure. You know? So it's not a huge difference. I would say like 60 to 70% of it is there. If you want to catch some finer action, then you got to get into the recordings only. Okay. Not responding. There's one organizer. Hey, may I know your name? Hello. Akash Shetty is not joining today. ZaranTech? No response. I think he has gone. Maybe just started the recording and left. Okay. All right, let me share my desktop. So you should be seeing the equivalent of this. I'm modifying these documents only. No, I'm not going by, it's all sort of pretty, not that organized, I would say, the modules that are there in ZaranTech training systems. So you should be getting this kind of trainings only, module one. I was just rearranged these slides. So if I show this one, module number two, module two, where are we? Topic two, module two, topic two. Module two, topic two. This is the one. Overview, it says, of inbound flow. I would say the inbound complete, you know, you call it overview or whatever. So here, this is the one I did, the one which we're going to talk today and tomorrow, or maybe, you know, some portion of it covered yesterday as well. So as usual, right, the inbound process, we know this is one of the mainstream process. In simple terms, it's collecting and carrying the goods. Are you guys seeing the PPT? Am I sharing the screen? So.
Yeah, Rajan, we can.
Right. So this is the collecting and carrying of the goods from receiving point to destination point. A quick run through, you know, I would say. This is talking about the ECC inbound delivery from the PO. It is interfaced to EWM and it gets IDN. So as you know, these are slightly old documents. So IDN not much of use nowadays, right? Especially the S4HANA. And then it contains the same information. It's just a copy of the inbound delivery. And then in the standard EWM system, a second document is created from the notification, which we call it as, again, inbound delivery, but it's ID. Over there, it's IBD. The short forms are acronyms. And it also has the same basic structure. Over and above, it has some status management and EWM specific data as well. The tracking, monitoring, you know, it's a mother document, also called as warehouse request. Okay, that's about it. And then the 404, you know, based on that document, the inbound delivery or the warehouse request, the EWM inbound delivery, we create the tasks. The tasks are used for execution. And these tasks are always assigned to the order. Whenever it has to be executed by an operator, there is no escaping. Even one pallet or one task, you get in a single order, right? And then the document flow, purchase order, inbound delivery, ECC inbound delivery or EWM inbound delivery, then task, task and order together. Finally, the put away using the task. And the GR, you know, quite flexible, can be triggered before put away or after put away confirmation. And then the GR trigger, we are talking about the GR trigger. At this point in time, you see the slide here, PO, ECC delivery, and then notification, and then the request or the EWM inbound delivery, against which we have the tasks and the order. And after confirmation of the task, the GR is triggered, or before the creation of the task also, as part of receiving. If the receiving operator completed the checks, then he can trigger the GR. You know, for example, there are some value-added activities happening. So for those reasons, you need to trigger the GR, yeah? Like quality inspection, lot creation, or deconsolidation. There's no escaping. You got to post the GR before those activities. So goods receipt mode, we talked about it. And this is a setting, you know, for decentralized WM. This setting is at the business system level, rather at the interface level. And here we talked about at least two of them. Immediately send means we don't wait. For every pallet that has been packed and good to go, we trigger the GR, meaning there could be more traffic or, you know, more postings happening. Whereas this is quite dangerous. Only send the full GR at the end of the put away process. No, the second one, item code 2. Send full GR when GR has been posted for all items. I think it's a subtle difference between the two. I'm referring to one only. Only send full GR at the end of the put-away process, meaning after completion of all put-away activities, you send the GR. This is what we said. There is a drawback or limitation. There could be some problematic pallets. Even though you have placed good portion of them, a good percentage of them, but still, for whatever reasons, a few pallets are causing grief, actually. You know, so for that reason, still the stocks are not available. So that's the only limitation. Otherwise, it just sends one GR. But you keep in mind, the system is not in sync. ECC and EWM both are not in sync because, you know, the GR posting is not reflected. So 2 and 3, I will come to that little later. Maybe, slightly tricky ones. The full mode and the collective mode. So the PPF is the one, keep in mind, that is the one sending. And we have some technical things also, you know, which is the PPF and what's the BAPI being called and other things. So it's not that old document. At the same time, not a new document also. For freshers or, you know, for beginners, it's okay, for starters at least. Now, purchase order can create with the following options, you know, vendor known, unknown, PO from requisition, stock transfer, all that the functions. Then the inbound delivery, we're talking about the inbound delivery. Then significance of the document category in EWM. In EWM, we have these many documents and a combination of document category and, you know, the document type combination is spawning out, or, you know, it's just spawning out this kind of these many documents in EWM. One for the header and one for an item. Item type is IDLV and the header is INB. And the category is PDI. So task about the task. Task is a basic document for any movements or even packing or even unloading. There are two types of tasks, product task and HU task. we will learn about that difference, you know, the product task and nature task difference. And the categories, there are, those are important, the WPT categories, which are put away, removal and internal and posting changes, broadly speaking. Then you know the task status, right? Open, cancel, waiting, and thing. So this talks about all the configuration nuances. Now today we're going to discuss about them, but before that, let's complete the master data exchange between these systems, and then we'll come back. So you should get these modules, you know, the so-called trainer PPTs are there. I think Akash, to touch base with Akash and or Syed maybe, yeah, and get these documents only. Okay, now I'm going back to my PPT. So where are we? We were in this exercise number 4, where we did the setup for TRKG, the rack storage, and also sections. We enabled the staging area as well. Now moving ahead, we'll talk about the storage bin. Right? The storage bin is the smallest spatial unit. The bin is not an org element. So far we have seen the org elements, storage type, section, and activity area is still pending. We have not covered the activity area. So let's jump to the bin for the time being. So the bin master is a master data, and a group of bins, you can call them as sections, a fast moving section or a AV section. And then in the bin master, the important fields are the bin type and the bin access type, not to be confused with the two, between the two. So the bin type is the one which brings in the dimensions and also the, basically if you say the dimensions, it's a volume or the weight and you know, a neutral capacity can be given via the bin type, or it can be directly assigned to the bin master. So both options are possible. When we say bin access type, that means whether a particular resource can access a specific level. For example, the reach truck can go all the way to the level number 6, whereas the forklift can go up to level 3 or level 4. So that is controlled by the bin access type, which resource can access a specific level or specific group of bins. That is controlled by the bin access type. Capacities we talked about, either directly we can assign the capacity or via configuration, you know, if you want a strict control or if you want to, you know, not the supervisor, just day in, day out, if you don't foresee any changes to the bin, then you can ensure that the assignment happens through the bin type and not a direct assignment. Else the direct assignment is also possible. And then, as I said, each bin has a coordinates. Not normally the nomenclature is aisle, stack, and level. But as I said, in EWM, there are two more identifiers, like the bin subdivision and bin depth. And also, you can, if you want your varus to be plotted in the XYZ scale, then you can do that as well. Hang on a second. Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, yeah.
Okay. Now, so the storage type, we have the section. Section is again grouping of bins, and bin is defined by the bin type. Bin is qualified by the bin type. So we talked about pretty much all of these, and then moving on here, storage bin data is a huge master data. It has several tabs, like there's a tab for bin data, wherein we talked about all these fields pretty much, storage type, section, bin access type, and fire containment section. XYZ coordinates if you want to plot your warehouse, especially for the travel distance optimization, maybe a phase 2 implementation. And bin depth also, we talked about it. And one more dedicated tab for physical inventory data. It's like when the cycle count happened or when the ad hoc inventory happened, whether the count posted with difference, without difference, all that information are there in the physical inventory data. And of course, the stock tab, wherein you see multiple records. Unlike in ECCWM, we don't have a quant number here. But if you see 10 records in the stock tab, that means 10 different quants are there in the bin. So each record will signify a quant. There is no quant number or there is no dynamic quant number concept in EWM. It's all stored in the LIME, the logistics inventory management engine. But in the monitor or in the bin master stock data tab, you would be seeing equivalent of quant in terms of uniqueness, as many records, as many quants. And also, you know, bin is, can be assigned to multiple activity areas. I'll come to that a little later. Then the warehouse task, which are the inbound tasks or which are the outbound tasks from the bin point of view, that information is also there. So there is a tab for showing the open put away task or picking task from the bin perspective. So this everyone knows for the freshers, maybe the aisle. This is the aisle, right? You go in a train, you see, this is the aisle, or in a flight, this is the aisle where the, you know, the air hostess moves. And then these are the stacks, right? 1, 11, 21, these are the stacks. And then these are levels, level 1, level 2, level 3, level 4, level 5. So aisle, stack, a stack is perpendicular to the aisle. And then the level is the one going vertically up, right? So aisle stack level, everyone knows. And if the bin is subdivided, you can have the subdivision also. Sometimes there are two deep, three deep bin also. So in that case, the depth acts also. Depth also acts as a qualifier. Any questions up until now? Is the volume okay or just very low volume? When I speak, is it just need to increase the volume or is it okay, guys?
It is clear, Raj.
Clear, right? Clear and sort of bold and clear, yeah. Loud and clear. Okay. Now, the bin masters can be created four different way. Okay. Either you can generate the bins using a template if it's following a standard, you know, it's not that chaotic. Meaning, for example, pretty much of the aisles are starting with the 1 to 30 stacks. There could be a few odd man outs, but that's okay. But assuming there are 20 aisles and most of the aisles are, you know, 1 to 30 stacks and level also, you know, maybe 1 to 7 or 1 to 6 levels, then in that case, you can just use a template with the start and end value and then create the bins using the template like we do in ECCWM, the start value, an end value and an increment, provided this makes more sense for a rack storage or, you know, where we have the proper nomenclature, aisle, stack, and levels. Otherwise, if it is quite haphazard, then we can use the CSV file upload. You know, you can get a file from the client and then upload the bin masters. Individually also you can create, for example, the interim bins or, you know, some one-off bins you can create individually using LS01 transaction. There's no N. And from the monitor also, you can just copy them and then change the prefix or anything. Because keep in mind, in EWM, the bin is unique at the warehouse number level. That's why the bin is having a huge 18 digits, you know, length, not like in ECCWM, maybe 10 digits over there, but here it's 18 digits. So we can have the luxury of, you know, having the storage type as the prefix, just in case, you know, if the uniqueness needs to be ensured. So handling unit we talked about, but before going to the handling unit, let me just show in the system the bin master data. And also I will try to complete the, you know, the exercise number 5. Quant. Before that, let's finish the quant. I don't know why this slides are swapped. The quant, you know, the existence of a material in a bin is called quant. If the bin is empty, that means there is no quant. Keep in mind, even there is no quant number in EWM, but still the quant concept exists. What does it mean, a quant? Quant means the uniqueness of a material. For example, if there are two batches in a bin, all right, that means two quants. Similarly, if the same product, same batch, maybe 60 quantity in unrestricted and 40 maybe on block stock, then there are two quants. So the quant is unique in terms of product, batch, stock type, or, you know, special stocks, or even the party entitled to dispose, which is your plant code. Anything that is deviating from here, that means you will end up a new quant. Quant means it's unique. Like in the world, there are, you know, 8 billion or 7 billion quants. So you can imagine, right? Each human being is unique. In that way, the product is unique in terms of the stock attributes. When we say stock attributes, these are the attributes like the plant code, the stock type, the special stocks, batch, country of origin, expiration date. So if anything changes, that means a new quant is generated and there is no scope for addition to existing stock. For addition to existing stock to happen, the quant attributes has to be 100% matching. Any questions on the quant understanding? KV, Aditya, Shiva, Shravan.
So, Rajan, one question, HU and non-HU, will they qualify as different quants or we can add stock to an existing HU in a bit?
Existing HU also we can add. The incoming ones, if it's an exact match, then you can go and add to the HU as well. Yeah. Based on the setting. Yeah. If the HU is anywhere mixed allowed, it also depends on the mix settings only, you know, at the storage type level. If we are allowing the mix, whether the batch mix allowed or product mix allowed, that means we can have multiple quants, mixed HUs basically. Yeah. Meaning on a given HU, there could be more quants.
Okay.
It depends whether you need a homogeneous, meaning only one quant, or you are allowing multiple quants based on the mixed settings in the storage type level. Okay, now I just jump to the activity data, but before that, as I promised, let me just show you the... show you this. Show you the system. Just give me a second. It's just been quite. Okay, how many participants we have? We have all of them. Shubha, Shwarna, all are there, okay. And Manish as well, okay. Now, yeah. So let's see the bin master SPRO. EWM, master data. Bin master, storage bins, storage bin, just a bin type, right? The bin type is the one we said, which brings in the dimensions or also the weight or the, you know, the neutral capacity or the unit less capacity. So here we have this weight or the volume. Volume can be given directly or using the LWH, the length, width and height. Or you can just give a maximum capacity. This is what I was referring to, neutral capacity, yeah? Because it's not having any dimensions. So this weight unit of the volume unit are getting defaulted from the unit of measures maintained at the warehouse level, you know, weight unit, volume unit, and the is what meters, right? Length, width, height, and YL, YM. See, now as I said, the bin type is bringing in those qualifiers, or bin access type. I'll just cover that little later. As at this point in time, you just keep in mind that the bin access type is more of LOSC controls, whether a particular equipment can access those bins, or you know, in terms of level, or in terms of for that matter, anything, you know, whether it's accessible or not by a resource. That is controlled by the bin access type. Now let's go to the bin identifiers. So normally the bin identifiers are ASLBD. Even you can use the XYZ, but this is a nice nomenclature. It's very easy to remember, like maybe a state in a province in Afghanistan and Pakistan, Islamabad. So A is aisle, S is stack, and L is the level. B is a subdivision, and D is depth. Only five qualifiers. And once we tag this ASLBD, now you go back. My God. Okay. Now, the bin structure. As I said, if it's following a nice pattern, very few odd man outs, then we can leverage the structure and create the bins. As usual, it's just like real. keep talking, but these guys are not acting at all. It's quite pathetic, guys. So now here we see. Yeah, good line, act line with 150 Mbps speed. Now, I don't know. So now you see here the structure is here given. Whatever we defined the qualifier in the previous config node is given here. A is aisle, S is stack, and L is level. Here we can just give the storage type as the prefix. And C means character, and N is numeric. Wherever you want the increment, then say N is a numeric. And the template, we are going with dot or hyphen. You can use normally the dash or the hyphen and or the dots. And then this is the start value, and this one is the end value, meaning I have one aisle, 30 stacks, and one level, So that means I have 30 bins created. But if I say aisle number 1 all the way to 9, and if I say level 1 to 4, how many bins? Anyone? Do the real quick math. 1 to 9 aisle, 9 times 30 is 270. 270 times 4, right? Which is 8 to 1080. 1080 bins. Is it clear to you guys? The start value, end value, the increment, and then the character and numeric values. Okay. And these are the qualifiers or the identifiers, aisle, stack, and level. You can just say B also, bin subdivision, bin depth. And for any template, storage type is mandatory. Section and bin type are optional, right? Because it's plug and play, you can change the section and bin type on a need basis. Because the supervisor, he would be frequently changing if the structure is also, changing. So he would be changing that. Or slotting might propose, to increase the bin size because, the need is more or the quantity required to be stored is more. And as I said, don't worry much on the XYZ. These are only required for the warehouse insights and your graphical warehouse layout. Eventually, the labor management with an accurate time and distance calculation. This would be phase 2. Let's not worry much about that. Any questions on the other fields we talked about? Let's speak, Aditya. Yeah. Let's make it more interactive. Just feel free, just whatever there in your mind, don't resist or just don't, bin them. Just keep them, keep asking them about the bins.
Yeah. So one question, Rajan, here is, compared to WM and EWM, you mentioned this bin will be a unique at a warehouse level, right? So right. Now for Y011, we are assigning this template of 1000. To 80 bins or something. So now for another storage type, if I give a similar structure, it will give a warning or an error that this it's not unique.
No. Yeah, it will give us an error message, because the bin being unique at the warehouse number level. That's why for another storage type, maybe Y012, you have the luxury of, giving differentiating year 2, even though the nomenclatures are same, even though it's 111. Okay. So you can differentiate by, changing this storage type that 3-digit can be utilized for that purpose.
So during configuration itself, it will raise an error, right? Not during bin generation. Yeah, okay.
I don't know precisely. I think the config only it will raise. But if it's not at the config, maybe at the bin generation for sure. It's too late in the game. Maybe I should imagine it stops here only. Who is that, Aditya?
Yes, Raj.
I think your questions are slightly interesting questions, but it's just a matter of time. We can figure it out. But most of your questions, I am, either getting bold or getting LBW. but it's just a matter of if you do it right, those things are immediately done. I mean, for sure, I think the error message comes, but don't know during structure creation or generation of bin. Are you sure you want to cancel? Yes. Okay. So now I'm going to create the bins. But before that, let me show you some more information about the bin master. Let me go to the monitor. Any other one? Any other questions from anyone?
Rajan, KV here. I don't know whether it's the same question. So in WM, we have that liberty to use alphanumeric and whatever bin name we can. It's a free text. but here it's all
here also we can give you know, format. No, you can, if you want, ad hoc brain creation, you can do them. This is the one I was talking now. If you have a structure, right, like the I'll start end incremented value, then you go for it. But you can create any alphanumeric or anything, doesn't matter. Yeah. No, I'm just taking an example of that, actually. Alphanumeric is also there, you see?
What I mean to say is it should be in the structural format, right? It should be in this structure. So it cannot be like bin A, bin B, just like how
you can create, you know, but bin A, bin B also you can create. But if you want to write on this aisle stack level, then you can say, for example, bin A, you know, A aisle, it corresponds to A aisle, then you can use it. Otherwise, you can create all day, always, you know, on the fly, for example, LS01N, or you can do a file upload, you know, say, for example, in rack storage, I want to create bin A, you know, not a problem.
Okay.
Create, you know, pin A. But this A, whether it signifies the aisle or stack or level, I know that if that things comes into picture, then maybe if you might be needing a template, you know, else you don't need a template. Like, for example, the work center bins or staging area bins or your interim bins, few odd bins, right? Maybe a couple of bins or, you know, or maximum 10 bins. So for that, you can create them directly here or, you know, use the Excel file. Okay. We don't have a separate transaction like in ECCWM to create all the interim bins, you know. Okay. Now, where am I? Yeah, I'm just going to the monitor. And here in the monitor, you can see you can basically use the method and then block the bin for total block or block for put away or removal. These things you know. And also, you can copy the bins and create a new bins here also. So this is the second way of creating the bins. The first one I showed you using a template. Second one is using the monitor method. You can just copy them and, you know, for example, if I have done for CPF, 10 bins, let's say, I copy them and then create them for EPF, each pick phase, by just changing the prefix. And also we can print the bin labels also from here. Basically, you can do block and block and print the label and also copy. And it stores the complete, you know, the error change logs. It's a beauty here. It shows the change log. And especially in EWM, we can have multiple fixed bins, right, for a product or other way around also. Multiple products can also be in a single bin. To track all those, you know, things and take some proactive action, because you see people on the fly, they may be invoking new bins and will end up finally, you know, for a single SKU, there could be 5 or 6 bins, which is quite ugly. Some point in time, you have to consolidate them. And ideally speaking, you can put a threshold so that, you know, people will not exceed those many bins. But assuming if you are not having thresholds and, you know, the capacity is not properly maintained, then most of the time people might put an exception code and, you know, keep changing the bin. And potentially, you know, the same product can be in, let's say, 5 bins. So in that scenario, you can use these reports, for example, the fixed bin reports, and see how much your product is scattered and, you know, whether a potential, you know, consolidation can be happening or not. All these reports would be handy, especially for the fixed bins, meaning one bin, multiple products, or one product in multiple bins, both the combinations. Now, let's go to this transaction called, I'll go to the bin master first. Just click here, it takes me to the bin master. So this is what I was talking about, right? We have multiple tabs, one for physical inventory, the other one for stock. Here, if you're seeing, for example, only one row, that means I have only one quant in this bin. Okay. If the exact attributes matches, for example, the plan code, the stock type, the owner, the timestamp, GR timestamp, you have the option at the storage type level. For example, if I receive earlier PO or earlier delivery from the vendor by, let's say, March 2022, and after 3 months, I am receiving one more consignment today. So it's up to you whether you want to keep the June month or, you know, the March month, or you don't want to mix. For example, March lot, let it be in the bin. You don't want to mix, and the June lot is kept in a different bin. Okay, this I'm talking about the non-batch managed product, because for batch managed product, batch anyway acts as a critical, you know, differentiating attribute. Any questions on this understanding, the stock and quant understanding?
Rajan, one more question, not sure if we I'll have to wait for that, or maybe we'll cover
If you have to wait, I will tell you.
So this GR date is what determines that FIFO rule, right? So if like normally in WM, what happens is if I add any stock to the same bin for that same part where the quant everything is same, then the oldest GR date is still kept here, right? So that
in WM, what happens? Yeah, only old date to be kept, or new date can also be kept.
Because if I want to follow FIFO, I should have the old date kept, right?
No, that doesn't matter. We are talking about old date is anyway picked, but the date is old or new that you are deciding now, right? Picking is a different story. First, we are deciding whether to keep the March date or the June date. You know?
Yeah.
Which one you want? In WM, what is there? Let's see the WM, no ECC WM.
Yeah, in WM, if
addition to stock,
addition to existing stock, yeah, addition to existing stock, then new date.
Where is the control date control?
That's what I am not clear, because I my assumption is it will still have the old date, because when I do FIFO, it has to still consider this bin because it has some old quants also.
How come, you know, if you're saying I have a lot received on March and I am again loading the same quant, adding to the quant today received, then the June date or March date, first we have to settle that, right? Forget about picking. Picking comes later, right? First, have you stored March date or June date, you know? That control is where in WM?
No, I'm not sure. So in this case, we should not have the addition to existing stock then, right? If it should be next empty bin, or
If you want to keep the lots individually, then you don't add. Okay.
Yeah.
But if you are adding, then you got to say whether you are liking the old date or the new date. You know. Understood.
So in EWM, we have that flexibility to choose.
I'll come to to EWM little minute. Yeah, we have the ultimate flexibility in EWM KV. So now, I'm just seeing the ECCWM, you know, I'm quite interested in ECCWM, even though it's just losing hours. Where was number E07? Okay, so what it's saying, addition to stock only. Yeah. Hello, addition to stock. But where is the date control? The indicator determined with the metal with particular categories may be added to the existence of the metal with the same categories. If the sort type control table does not allow addition to stock, but this sort of the indicator set in the metal master strike code is ineffective. So storage control should allow. And then here we say addition to stock, whether the old date or new date. Okay, forget about this. You know, anyway, we don't want to waste our energy. Now let's go to the EWM. Now in EWM, it's quite nicely done, I would say. So here we have the control GR dates, right? For example, whether you want the earliest date dominant or most recent date dominant. By default, the most recent date. And if you want to switch to earliest date, it's okay. Not allowed also, we have a function, you know, meaning it will not allow, even though other attributes are matching. Because of the date, it might, you know, suggest a new bin. And the beauty here is it's some products you can have the earliest date. Some other products we can have the recent date. So this is the beauty of, you know, EWM. Are you guys following with me?
At product level, if you want to control, we should keep 3 as the setting in storage type, you're saying, right?
Right. Product put-away profile decides. Yeah.
Okay.
So you need to create a put-away profile and send it to the product master. And for some products, the put-away profile, we can say earliest date, you know, but the control goes to the put-away profile then, but the earliest date or recent date, the similar settings are there at the put-away profile as well. Okay. Not allowed means the June batch will not be mixed. The June batch is directed to another bin.
Yeah, so it doesn't allow you to add.
It doesn't allow you to add.
Okay.
It has to be another bin, Rajan, or it can be a new quant in the same bin. Can it be a new quant in the same bin if we put not allowed?
New quant means how will you differentiate, right? It's a material with the same other attributes. You can't have, right? It's very dicey. Okay. Potentially, you know, picker will go and, you know, do some mistakes, actually. Even though you have put some labeling and, you know, nice flashy labels, yellow label, orange label for March batch and June batch, you can manage, you know. but I never tried actually. It's not a recommended one. If you're just you don't have batch management, and if you're keeping two different lots, better to keep it in two different bins actually. That's advisable. But if you want to, in a Jugaad way, you want to put some partition and, you know, put some nice label and do that, I think there should be a way out. You know? But it should be a forced one only. Not allowed means it will not allow in the bin, simple. You know, it will suggest a new bin only. And when you're adding, it will, it might stop you also, you know. Yeah. Again, Aditya, your question's really tricky, you know, the ones where you need to test only, but a matter of time only, you know, you can just quickly do the testing. I think it should stop. My gut feel says not allowed means it will not allow you in the bin. Okay. You can't differentiate the con. Okay, now let's move on. Similarly, we have for expiration date also, you know, I just carry the momentum and finish it. So expiration date also, we have similar things. So. Can a SLED can be maintained for a non-batch managed product? Anyone? Is it possible to have SLED for a non-batch managed product?
I think so, yes.
Maybe. Yeah, the question itself, you know, is giving the clue that it should be technically possible. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah,
fine. So yeah, the SLED for that also, we have the earliest date, latest date. This is basically for the non-batch managed product. Okay, now, right, let's move on. Where are we? In the bin master, physical inventory tab. Then the bin sectioning is applicable for some special storage like pallet storage, where the bin is subdivided automatically. We'll come to that a little later. Then the statistics, it keeps a basic record like we have in ECCWM, when the last movement happened, first put away when it happened, you know, the, what do you call that, the Diwali day, Muhurat trading, you know, first day, auspicious day for the year opening. So, and then the warehouse tasks, right, which are the open task and the picking task, the outbound task from the bin point of view, then the activity areas. For example, this bin is in multiple activity areas. So for picking, it is in a different number, maybe for put away, maybe a different number. So one bin can be in multiple activity areas. And also the PSA assignment, the production supply area assignment. So bin master is a huge one, but the main tab is here. In this tab, that's where we give the bin type, the bin section assignment, fire containment, bin type, your XYZ mapping, right? And the weight and volume can be directly assigned or via the bin type. Okay, so having said all these things, let's do the exercise number of 5. Any questions before we do that exercise number 5?
And how, like you mentioned that there is no transaction to create that interim bins, right, Rajan? Like WM.
Yeah, you just go to LS01 and then create or upload the Excel file. If there are 20 bins, then Excel file.
So first, prior to that, we have to prepare a list of interim bins by validating the config.
Not validating, right? Interim bins are interim bins, right? So you can create, for example, expedite packing, you know, Deco Work Center, Deco S Station 1, Station 2. Yeah, all text bins, right? So
text.
What do you want to validate? I mean, nothing to validate, right? Just interim bins. Like you have that, you know, the German word, what's it, for trash, something is there, right? All that bins, a scoff, gif, and other things, they are bins. So. All right, so. Now, let me show you how to create the bins using the template structure. So we're going to create the rack storage, TRKG, aisle 1 to 10, and stack 1 to 6, level, you know, A to C are fast moving. And the topmost level D and E are slow moving. Okay, D and E slow moving. Level number A to C is fast moving. That means I have 10 times 6, 60. 60 times 3, 180 bins, fast moving bins. And here I have 10 times 6 into 2, 120 bins slow moving. So all together I have, should create 300 bins. Right? 180 fast moving bins and 120 slow moving bins. And also I create some bins for individually, you know, maybe 2 bins I create individually. And some more bins, if you want, you can practice the Excel file. You know, you can download, upload. You can do that stuff if you are interested. Okay, so you learned these 3 things actually: how to create a bin, how to create a bin. So as I said, the bin creation. Where am I? Yeah, the bin creation can be using the template LS10 or file upload, CSV file upload, or using the individual creation LS01 or the monitor. Four different options are there, okay? But mostly in a typical implementation, if it's structured, you use the template, else you do the CSV file upload as part of the preparation for go live, you know, or even the cutover or the mock cutovers, you get the file neat and clean, you know, refined or filtered or, you know, up to date. So individual bin creation, very rarely the people will do. Nevertheless, the supervisor would be, you know, creating the ad hoc bins on the fly when needed. Okay, let's complete this exercise number five. I'm going to my config rack storage. Right, where is the rack storage? DRKG. I'm building my warehouse. Let me see if my warehouse runs, else I will move to another warehouse. Storage bins. Let me see the identifiers for my EW17. Yeah, it's there, ASLBD. Okay, then I go to the structure, then EW17. Rack storage is not there. Okay. So what I'm going to do, smartly, I'm going to select from EW07, DRKG, right? DRKG, sorry, here it's there. So just go inside and maybe in a display mode, okay, go on. EW07 TRKG. Let's go in display mode. Now I open another session, SEWM. Don't remember, I think the SPR only. So, template EWM, master data, storage bins, bin template, bin structure. Now for my warehouse, EW17. So I just create a new entry, EW17, and copy this nicely. Let me see if I can copy correctly. I always fail. It came properly. So the x-axis starts at 50 meters, and then the y at 115, and then the z is 0. X increment is 2 meters, Y increment is 1 meter, okay, blah, blah, blah. The racks, DRKG, and section, if I want, I can give fast section. You can modify them little later, no problem. So I'm saying aisle number 1 to 10, stack number 1 to 6, and aisle 8, level A to C. Okay, increment is 111, 10. Now, I can assign a bin type also, PAL1, done. So I save this entry. Similarly, I do it for now. I can copy this guy now in my warehouse. I can copy this because the sequence number, you know, it has to be in your warehouse. That's why I was opening another session. Sequence number is important, but if you're doing the business within your own warehouse, then automatically the sequence number is taken. But you can't copy from another warehouse because there could be sequence number issues. So now I said for aisle D, sorry, level D and E, D to E, this is slow mover. And maybe the bin type is PAL2. Get done. So two records created. That's what we are expected to do. First check the identifier and create 16 AC and then 1 to 6 D and E, slow movers. Done. So I got to generate the bins now, and then some bins I'm going to create individually. So how to generate the bins? So you go to the index screen or easy access screen. Index or easy access, one and the same. So here we go, logistics, EWM, master data, bin, generate bins, LS10. If you want, you can just add to the favorites. It should be in your favorites. I think I have 2 LS10. So let me just check this out. Delete the favorites. Okay, we have the LS10. Okay, now the newly added ones should appear here. EW17, right? So these are the newly added ones. So I can just go and generate the bins, create bins, 180 bins, good, create. You can schedule a background job also. If you're creating tens and thousands of bins, then you can schedule a background job also. Since this record is completed, now I can hit the black arrow, and then again, do it for the second record, 120 bins, slow moving, create the bins. So now you know how to create the bins using the structure. Now I'm going to create some ad hoc bins using LS01 directly. So I just create these two bins. Actually, in fact, these many bins needs to be created. So let me just do it for Y911 alone. You know, so just go SPINBS and then Y911 storage type Y911 and then the section. So it's as easy as that, you know, so we can create our bins quickly. For the remaining bins, I'm going to create a file. So let me just show the file out to the web. So you can go to this transaction now and then download the file, Excel file. So bin master, upload bins, load bins, you see, loading bins, SBUP. So if you want, you can download the file here, spreadsheet. So you can save as Excel or save as Excel. Okay, you can save it in your desktop. Okay, bin upload or whatever. Bin upload. Okay, and then the Excel would be there. This is Excel. So these are the fields we need to populate. You know, warehouse numbers, storage bin, store type, section, bin type. All the fields are here. Okay, all the weights go into the AP. You know, so those many columns are there. Now I think I have the file already. You know, available. Let me show the file, the bin upload file. So what bins I have? Okay, the remaining bins I have. All these bins need to be created for now EW17. Right. So the one which I have just now created is Y911. It's not there anyways. So these many bins I have to create. Pack work center, the section is 01. Yeah. Okay. These many bins needs to be created. I'm not sure whether the bins exist in my warehouse. So I go to LS11 and see if the bins are there. You know, all the Y11 show me to Y921. Y921 showing it from Y811 maybe. Okay, just show me. Okay, we have some bins here. I don't want to. 812 is there. No worries. Delete them. Then let me just sort them. 812 then. 830 is also there. 830 anyway. I don't need. And 33 as well. Okay, if it is not there, then you maintain them. 861, 910, 911. Okay, 861, scrap bin. Okay, done. So 910, 911, 920. 910 and 920. These two bins, let us not worry. Okay, now the remaining bins are good to go. I save this file and maybe I save it as a CSV file. Save as a CSV. Okay, done. Now let me show you how to upload. As of now, you can imagine we have three, how many bins we have? 3, 5, 7, 10 bins are there. Let us do the upload now. Okay, I go back to the transaction, load bins, and then upload. Sorry, in my desktop. All right, so we are creating these many bins, you know, 3, 5, 7, 9 more bins. So totally we should have 19 bins, you know. So all good, looks good. Now I press the button, create. So 5 bins only got created. The remaining bins may be, not sure, successful changes, failed changes, loaded bins. why the remaining not got loaded? Section mismatch or whatever. So now you know, right, how to create the bins using the file, also the individual bins, and also using the template. So that's all about exercise number 5. And finally, you should be seeing these many bins. If not, you know, maintain the Excel file and upload them. Okay. But just keep in mind that you should be doing it in your warehouse. So any questions on the bin master? Guys, are you guys there?
No.
No questions. Okay. TRKG, let's show you now. Okay. So we have these many bins, and you see these are tagged as aisle. See here. Aisle. Sorry, bin level A. And where is that ASL? We said the ASL, right? Somewhere it should be shown. No? It's not here. It's not here. Maybe here. Aisle 1, stack 1, and level A. See, aisle, stack, level. Okay, so that's the main advantage of this. Now, and you know, right, we can do many things from here. If you want to change the section, change the bin type, or, you know, reset it back, you can change the weight, volume, all that we can do, you know. So this is a mass change transaction, except for the bin blocking. The bin blocking and unblocking has to happen using the monitor method. Okay, a quick time check. It's now 10:03. Are there any questions? I'm done with exercise number 5. Let's move on to the next topic, activity area. Before that, any other clarifications or questions on this bin master? Very interesting topic. The bin master is a master data. All right, let's move on. Now, activity area. So what is activity area? Again, logical grouping of bins. At the end of the day, you see section is grouping of bins, you know, storage type also grouping of bins, but for different reasons, you know. For example, storage type could be a pick phase, corrosive items or cool room items, you know, or section could be fast mover, slow mover, medium mover. Whereas activity area is grouping of bins to perform some activities. For example, you can imagine the courier person, right? So he is carrying a lot of couriers, you know, that has to be dispatched in a huge street. So he goes like this, you know, toggle between the odd number houses on the left hand side and even houses on the right hand side. So he just get the point. So he goes in this like this in this fashion and then, you know, completes the job. And at the end of the street, maybe he's just having a coffee and enjoying, you know, there's no need to go revisit. Once it's all sorted, the parcels are sorted, then it's easy for him to, you know, just to propose and then go. Then likewise, the activity area is grouping of bins. It could be any combination, you know, with regards to the storage type. It could be one-to-one or many-to-one or many-to-one or one-to-many, you know. So in this example, I have two storage type, one for small parts, another one for large parts. But this activity area is spanning across these two storage types, you know. So it's having a common area, which is called a golden zone or a fast moving zone or a fast picking lane. So this guy goes inside and then comes out, maybe, you know, or in a U pattern, he goes with the trolley and then takes a U turn. And then while coming back, he just grabs all these things, fast picking lane. Okay. So that is the main idea of activity area. You group the bins for a given activity. In this case, it's a picking activity. Likewise, you can do for put away, you can do for, you know, physical inventory, counting, can do. So the main idea is PPO, put away path optimization or pick path optimization. And these things comes into picture when you're doing a cart based put away or a trolley based put away. But if you're doing individual put away, then it's not a big deal because anyway, you're carrying one at a time. There is no question of, you know, optimization or, you know, avoiding the back and forth movements. So for a given activity area, for a given activity, you group the bins and sort the bins. And these bins would be proposed in that sort sequence in the mobile device. When the operator is confirming in the mobile device, the system will suggest them in a proper, you know, system guided mode, one after the other. So there is no back and forth movements, and is a, you know, productivity or efficiency is ensured. Are there any questions on this PPO understanding? the main usage of activity area. But activity area is pretty much everywhere in EWM. You know, it has a very wide usage in terms of work center determination, the whereas the creation rules, the queue determination, wave template determination, many usages. You know, I can go on and on. At least some 10 usages I can talk about that. But at this point, you guys should know PPO. It's just two birds in one stone, or you know, one shot. Put away path optimization and pick path optimization. Anyone knows what is CLSP, cross line stock put away? It's the ECC WM term, you know, especially the Aditya, KV. You guys know what is CLSP?
No, Rajan.
CLSP is cross line stock put away. The only difference is that is also an activity. So far, we know the activity means put away, picking, replenishment, and physical inventory counting. But CLSP is one more activity, but that happens during task creation. Rest all activities happening during confirmation, meaning the bins would be proposed in that sequence number. Each bin master will carry a sequence number, you know, for a given activity. The same bin can have, for example, a sequence number 13 for put away, and maybe, you know, sequence number 1 for picking. So different sequence number for different activities. CLSP is the one which triggers during put away, meaning cross line stock put away. What is this? Is the one, for example, if you are not done the CLSP sorting, then your aisles would be one sided loaded. You know, few aisles would be targeted, and the same few aisles would be, you know, targeted for picking also, meaning the remaining guys will not get any work. If you are running the warehouse, you know, 40% or 50% capacity, assuming you are having, you know, aisle 1 all the way to 20, maybe aisle 1 to 8 is targeted, and then, you know, the workload is concentrated. This is called, you know, one-sided loading. One-sided loading means some clients will say, oh, this is not going to topple. It's not a question of toppling or, you know, turning topsy-turvy, but this is mostly about, you know, like if the mundane, or you know, the not a great analogy, but still I will give the analogy, like you're taking a 5-bedroom apartment, you know, there are many family members, but what is the fun in if everyone is using, you know, one washroom, or you know, one sit out, the remaining washrooms or sit outs are not being used. It's that kind of scenario can be compared to CLSP. So if you do the CLSP sorting, then it is going like a snake, you know, so it ensures that the front of the warehouse, we are filling to the rear of the warehouse, you know, so that everyone gets the uniform distribution of workload. If there are 5 pallets that needs to be retrieved, all 5 forklifts will get the, you know, one pallet at a time. It's not that everyone is, you know, going and creating a, you know, chaos here, some head-on collision, or, you know, waiting game, blaming game. Any questions? Have you understood CLSP? It's quiet, man.
Yeah, it is clear.
Clear right now, yeah. Okay. So now let's move on. Activity area. So first we are defining activity area. So in our rack storage, we have 2 activity areas. The yellow zone and the blue zone, RKG1 and RKG2. And these are for put away only, you know. So how do I map them granularly? For example, aisle 1 to 4, you know, it is RKG1. Similarly, aisle number 5 alone is still in RKG1. And aisle number 7 to 10 is RKG2. On the aisle number 6 also RKG2. This screenshot is not showing the last, you know, record. Anyways, is it clear how to, you know, subdivide a storage type? We said in a given storage type, there could be multiple activity areas, right? For example, aisle 1 to 4 manned by, you know, Aditya. Aisle number 5 is a special aisle, you know, I am responsible for the aisle. Aisle number 7 to 10, again, you know, this is by Saurav. All right, so that's how you do your granular mapping. And here I am saying these are the default aisles. Aisle 1 to 4 is a default aisle, and aisle 5 and 6 are special aisle. So what is so special, if you look at my, the layout, then you will appreciate that. Then finally, you give all the things, you know, whether aisle ascending, descending. Normally what happens, you give preference to stack because the level is reaching is difficult, you know. So normally you give preference to stack, meaning if I am moving here as a postman or a courier person or delivering, so it's easy for me to do 1, 2, 11, 12, Then I may be coming one more time to attack all the levels, you know, because I need a reach track. Maybe I will complete all the ones which are at the, you know, the ground level or maybe at the reachable level. Okay. And then I will get one more equipment and then I will go. So that's why, you know, I'm sorting first based on the stack, followed by level. Of course, I'll then stack and level. So there are n number of ways to do many magic here. Sorting dial, then the directions are important. Ascending, descending. What does it mean, ascending and descending? So this could be an inward aisle, you know, and then this could be an outward aisle. So this means he's going there and then taking a U-turn and then coming out. Actually speaking, it's a safety restriction. The operator cannot go inward in this aisle number two. You know, potentially there could be a head-on collision. So that's why it's a U pattern or maybe a S pattern. You know, some aisles are marked as inward aisle, some are marked as outward aisle. So here we do the ascending sorting. And while he's taking a U-turn, the stacks would be proposed in a descending fashion. Or he can flip the switch in the mobile device, you know. So that's why there is an ascending and descending option there. You see, stack ascending, stack descending, and also alternating. Alternating means the odd man on the left-hand side and the even ones on the right-hand side. Both sides, you have to say. You know? So whatever gimmicks you do here, at the end of the day, if you are not getting the sort number properly, then you ask the client for an Excel file and then upload them. Like we do the bin master upload. Similarly, we can do the sorting update also by a file upload. You know, if it is pretty chaotic and you are not achieving using these many configuration fields, and mostly it is not sacrosanct, things are dynamically changing, and the supervisor is, you know, very comfortable in doing via Excel. So give the Excel file and let him be happy. Any questions on this slide? Chandru, Swarna, Saurav, you guys are following or I'm going on a faster pace now? Following, right? Just let me know, huh, if I'm just rushing through, I guess put a stop on. You guys have the control for the gear shifting. Okay. No questions? All clear? Crystal clear? Now. This is the main purpose of, you know, plotting the values in the XYZ scale. For example, you know, we have the leftmost, you know, the absolute scale. From there, we say 25 x-axis and then y-axis, you know, 50. We have this receiving area starting. And then this could be your shell storage. This could be your IRAX, you know. And wherever you see these blue lines, that's where the system calculates the travel distance, you know. For example, if I want to move from here, I just go here, I go here, I go here, and then I just enter here, and then I travel to the aisle. So these are called edges, and the junctions are called node, like the, you know, chakras in the human being. So like the node and then the edge. Okay, so you have to go to the node and then join another edge. So the system calculates the distance of the edge, you know. So this is all plotted, and this is quite painstakingly done if you want to do it in the backend. But nowadays, you know, there is a module called the cloud-based Varus Insights. With that, we can easily plot your values. It's not that complicated compared to doing it in the back end. But this used to be a very famous transaction. This is there since 2006 or 7, graphical values layout. But nothing majorly happened. At least the supervisor will get a bird's eye view of the block bins, or, you know, especially used for crane systems, conveyor system. If there's any blocking happen, then it will, you know, alert the supervisor. Otherwise, you get a picture of where the bins are. You know, most of the empty bins are there, and whether blocked bins are available. So you get a feel about that. But nowadays, people are looking at, you know, the 3D graphical representation of the yard and the various insights. So this one is pretty much, I would say, obsolete. Not to be worried much. Any questions? Hello. Okay, let me show you one quick video also, you know, the graphical warehouse layout equivalent one, the warehouse insights. Let me just unshare. Just give me a time. I'm unsharing this and then I'm sharing a video. There's no audio anyway. I'll just talk if required. Where is the file? Okay, I got the file now. Let me share the file. Include system audio. There is no audio anyways. So this is the one. Varro's insights, yeah. Varro's visualization, yeah. This is a cloud-based tool. And this one is getting more interested now. Because of the robots and many things are happening, the insights. So you see the Varro's equivalent of the graphical Varro's layout. The nodes are the circle ones, you know, and then the edges are the lines, you know. And you see, if I want to create a edge, I can just right click on a node, and then I can right click a destination node. And I can construct edge, simple as that actually. So we can zoom in, we can, you know, do all adjustments. It's quite easy. There, the zooming in and zooming out is pretty constrained. By right click, you know what are the levels. See, for example, you know, here we have A, B, C, D, E, the bin levels. And, you know, just gives the bin information, the bin type, bin length, X, Y, Z coordinate, all that. Yeah. Now I give a specific bin. And I can just, if I want to show all the storage types, I can select them. Or if I want to focus on a few storage types, I can do that. So in this case, I'm selecting a few storage types. Then I can do the work, you know, without seeing the remaining ones. So back to the display of all. Now, this is the beauty, you know, travel path calculation. So how much distance I am going to travel from a source bin to a destination bin. Okay. I selected one source bin from the rack storage. And to the maybe a clarification zone. So to the clarification zone, what's the travel distance? So it says clearly 35.8 meters. You know? And this is ultimate, you know, I can give a Varro's or a number. Imagine this could be a multi-hop and, you know, multiple points they have to go, multiple destinations are there, meaning a trolley based put away. For this scenario, you can calculate the travel distance. You know, this is really beauty. Just directly, you can give the Varro's or a number and see the distance. See, it's just going from that particular bin to the staging bay, 35 point whatever meters. Any questions? Shiva, Swarna, Shrivan.
No.
Okay, well, let's take a break, maybe a 15 minutes break, and catch up at 10:35. You know, see if you guys coming a little early also, it's fine. 10:35 we'll start, you know, the action, the last 1.5 hours action. All right, talk to you then. Hey, Akash, are you there? ZaranTech, anyone? Hello? No. Okay. So now, where are we? We did the quant and then the bin handling unit. We know about the handling units. Just one more time, one last time. Product along with the packaging material together handled as one unit is handling unit. There are different types of HUs in EWM, homogeneous or mixed HUs or heterogeneous. Then the nested HU, where we have the top HU and then the child HUs, put away HU, pick HU, ship HUs. And the mobile device, we talk about the source HU and destination HU in terms of the screen navigation. And then if there are multiple deliveries packed into an HU, that's cross delivery HU. Deconsolidation HU, the HU which is meant for deco, you know, the potential HU which is, needs to be taken to the deco station, that is called deconsolidation HU for bulk break-in, or it could be a mixed HU. Then slotted HU are the ones which you can basically have compartments in that, and then for example the retail world, you know, where we have the shelves with the assortment of items, the complete shelf comes to the pick point. And then it's a goods to man system. Okay. But normally we know HU, it need not be a pallet. It could be any form, normally cartons and wire baskets and the warehouse cage, and also the plastic totes or the crates being used. When it comes to yard management, it's a transportation unit or the container. And sometimes, you know, we track the vehicle also. Okay, now, quant we know. And then the activity area, pretty much at least we know the PPO and also the CLSP significance, two usage of activity area we know. Keep in mind the CLSP triggers during the task creation. The remaining things happens during task confirmation. Especially this makes sense in a mobile environment, you know, where it's system guided and sort of multi-step put away, or, you know, multiple points where the operator has to, you know, visit. Basically a card-based put away. Now, activity area configuration also we know. Now, I'm going to do the configuration for this activity. And graphical warehouse layout, we saw that. And the insights, you know, the new, the cloud-based equivalent of it is emerging now. And bin creation I have done. And activity area I got to do, axis number 6. I just hold it for a time being. Then work center. Work center is again master data. Even though work center is a storage type with a role, but still work center masters, because there could be multiple workstations. We need to do the bin assignment and then the the terminal name assignment, and maybe a scale interface to capture the weight.
We have seven participants.
Hello?
Wait,
okay, questions are just some background, if you guys can go on mute. Okay, now the work center, similar to the staging area, we can do the granular mapping using the section and the basically section. Yeah, so here is storage type, only one section is there. We are clueless whether it's a inbound section or work completed or still work in progress, but here at least we have some visibility, you know, the inbound ones are there, which could be common for multiple workstations. So this workstations can be compared with your you know, if you go to any hypermarket or any retail store, there are multiple billing counters, right? You can imagine like that. So each workstation there for billing or checkout. So you have this, you know, the terminal name and the packaging material frequently used can be given here. At the end of the day, you create a work center and assign the storage type here. Let me zoom in. So you create a work center, DW1 or DW2, Deco Work Center 1 or 2, and assign those storage type here, which is of role work center, and also the sections, inbound section and outbound section. Right. If you are using three sections, that's fine. I will talk about, you know, how the third section is being pulled in. The normal layout we need to define. For example, if you are doing the transaction in the back end, so same like your monitor, we have three parts, the three structure on the left hand side, and then the scanning area on the top right. Okay. Let me just push this guy back. Yeah. Okay. Let me then zoom in now. Okay, zoom in. Okay, so here we have this tree structure and then the scanning area. Normally people do, the operators would be scanning the HU, the packaging material or the product code, or, you know, the UPC or the EANs. And this is the area, you know, where additional functions are there. So in order to configure them, we need to manipulate the layout provided by SAP. Okay, there is a layout called, you see, DKMX. And finally, you marry the bin. You assign the bin to the to the work center. And as I said, we can give a terminal name and also the frequently used packaging material, which is sort of default, and also the scale, you know, just in case if they need tolerance, so that, you know, it would be moved to the clarification area. So that's about the work center as a master data. And this is one Fury application, nice Fury application. It's designed for the e-commerce world. So assuming the picker has brought the source HUs here, pick HUs or source HUs, whatever, source for this guy, you know, the pack-in operator. So let's say he's a pack station operator. He's doing the outbound deliveries packing. He has three types of carton boxes, large, medium, small, or maybe, you know, extra large, extra small also maybe. So now his idea is to, you know, optimize the shipping units or the ship HUs. He doesn't want to send, you know, 2-3 cartons. Rather, he can put everything in one carton, which is the most likely scenario. Or there could be more pieces that needs to be put in smaller cartons also, depending on the, you know, optimization things. So this is the pack workstation Fury application you see here with a nice, you know, image. And when they scan the HU, the tote which was picked, it shows all assortment of items, you know, like the blue T-shirt, yellow T-shirt, blue shoes, digital camera. All that that are there by just scanning the HU, the source HU, or the, you know, bin, assuming if they are having the bus bay kind of thing, like you drop individual trays in the cafeteria, right? When you're going for a lunch in a cafeteria, nowadays people are working from home. But if you are just going, imagine, you know, you leave the truck in a particular tray in a level, right? In a trolley. So likewise, you know, if the picker drops this tote in a specific slot on a bus bay, then you can scan that bin as well. So if you know the HU, you can scan the HU, and then it shows the contents. From there, you can transfer it to the ship HU. On the right-hand side, you see the ship HU. On the left-hand side, you source HU. And here it shows how much weight being used, you know, on the shipping carton weight being consumed. The system keeps a tab on this weight being consumed. And it has a lot of features, you know, it supports batches, serial numbers, a scale interface, product picture, delivery instructions. Just in case if the delivery is canceled, it can react to the order reduction or reduced, you know, when the customer reduces the quantity, immediately a pop-up comes and, you know, we can, for example, 10 quantity initially as ordered. Now that it changed to 7, so we can just, you know, keep the 3 removed from the delivery. Also, we can... assign preferred packaging materials to the work center. Any questions on this slide? Despite giving these many features, still there are a lot of limitations. So SAP is saying, you know, either you buy from the consulting partners, they're selling it for a good amount, maybe, you know, some good money. These are the limitations are there. So you can't use the pack specs. You can't use the same source HU as the destination HU. So it sucks. Sometimes, you know, these are still limitations. We have to live with this. You can't add auxiliary packaging material. Catch weight is not supported. You know, a whole nested HU into a ship HU, you can't pack. So these are mostly required for the Coca-Colas and Red Bulls of the world, you know. So the source HU cannot be adapted as a shipping HU. So these are still limitations. Thanks to some of the partners, they have developed many. They basically, they overcome these restrictions. Any questions, KV, Saurav, Stravan, Manish, Goyen?
Yeah. This outbound delivery packaging, so we're just looking at the Fury app, but even in the GUI, SAP GUI.
GUI is the expert mode, you know, you have more features, but at the same time, it's dull looking and, you know, it's not built for the e-commerce world.
Right.
Like you have the... This still makes sense, you know, if, especially if you're,
So we have all the flexibility here in GUI, and so just that the Fury app
look and feel, and you know, some more. We have all the features, you know, you name it, all the. I would say that's an expert mode. Here it's a very limited, you know, user-centric application. At the same time, you know, it's not that bad. I mean, good amount of features are there, but just keep in mind, still. many people are doing developments and, you know, connecting this to the carrier interface. In one of the implementations, instead of connecting this Fiori application to the parcel carrier like FedEx or UPX, they have taken the backend, you know, thing and integrated with the carrier. That's not recommended. But if you are using the Fiori application, better integrate with, you know, this with your small parts or parcel carriers, basically. Okay, this is a note number, just in case, you know, make a note of it, or it's there in the recording as well. That's showing the limitations and, you know, where to buy, what to buy, all that information. Now, just a quick
question. A normal process, when I create a delivery, as we are maintaining the packing instructions, immediately the item gets packed. Okay, so now this delivery is moving to EWM.
So this is outbound delivery.
Yeah, outbound delivery. Yeah. So the packing instructions will be maintained, and when I create the delivery, the line item gets packed.
Okay.
So the same delivery will move to EWM, right? So along with the packing, it will go, or how?
Here I am talking about, you know, people bringing the e-commerce things, you know, on plastic.
No, I am not asking about e-commerce. I am asking in general about an outbound delivery where it is packed, then it will move to EWM.
If you are doing each picking, for example, right, or picking in
I am not a general question. I am not asking anything about picking. I am asking in general about packing. When I create a delivery, it is packed automatically. So the same delivery will move.
Who said it's packed automatically, right? You are assuming.
Means we maintain. No, we do. We maintain pack instructions, so it will pack automatically.
Pack instruction, right?
That is a business requirement, right?
Okay, then in that case, it's not required to brought to pack work center, right? So you are having the pack instruction, and your delivery is packed. Maybe you carry that package, the labels, and then you do on the fly packing. That's what you're saying. So you maintain a pack instruction, for example. What is the item type you are maintaining? Pack instructions, there are, I don't remember, 0 OBD, maybe the condition type. So you are packing the delivery. For example, if you are picking 30 quantity, I'm just, you know, thinking loudly. Three HUs are, you know, suggested by the system. Put 10 each. So you go with 10, right? Either as part of the warehouse order, mostly, right? These are called pick HUs, or you can use them as ship HUs also. So you can do on the fly, you know, while going for picking itself, you can go with 3 cartons, and then you pick those 10 each, and then move to staging bay. Yeah.
No, I'll ask in a different way. Forget about it. So the current ECC supports give me an option of making packing instructions. Will that be still valid for EWM?
The current ECC is giving pack instruction. The ECC instructions are not valid. Packing instructions means you are talking about the POP, POP, POF ones.
Yes.
That is not valid, right? I mean, you can't pack before you pick. No, if at all you want to pack, means it's planned HUs only. You know, you call it planned ship HUs, or, you know, cartonization planning, or pick HUs. You know, let's put it that way: pick HUs or ship HUs. You are planning in advance. But I never, you know, I can't imagine the one using the POP and the POF. These things are so many advantages, or many, you know, better things are there when it comes to EWM. You can create the planned ship HUs using your WOCR creation rules, or you can use the pack specs in EWM. Else you can use the TM module, you know, to come out with the proposals. But I can't appreciate this POP one, POPs and, you know, I never tried that also.
Rajan, this
who is that? Shravan Kumar or Shiva?
Yeah.
Who's that man? Shravan Kumar. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So Rajan KV here. So the pack specs. So in a way that helps here, right? So even though that's
the pack specs is not leveraged in the work center. You know, that's what is the limitation. So you can't, by click of a button, you can't invoke the pack specs in within the, you know, pack workstation, either the Fiori application or the backend application. We can't do it.
Okay.
If you see the limitation, the one which I opened, the note, it says the pack specs cannot be used.
That I understand. So maybe for this moment, let's not go into the Fiori app.
Even the backend app also, you know, the pack specs, you can't leverage on the pack specs. There are condition types for the pack specs. For example, zero OBD, you know, wherein you can the delivery itself while landing in EWM, it can suggest the pick HUs or ship HUs. When I say pick HUs, you can imagine, you know, these are ship HUs also possible. Pick HUs means the ones which are rotating within the warehouse, you know, circulating within the warehouse, like a plastic totes, you know, or temporary cartons or temporary totes. You know? Now the question is, I'm just showing the work center full-fledged functionality, you know, wherein you pick the each items, assortment of items, picked by a picker, and brought to the pack workstation. But there are n number of scenarios. Like I said, you know, the TM can send the planned ship HUs, or in EWM we can have the planned HUs created as part of delivery or as part of the warehouse or the creation rule, you know, wherein you it's not mandatory that it, things have to come to the pack work center for packing. This is one scenario. Yeah. Okay. Shravan, makes sense or?
Yeah, I think when we discuss more about the outbound delivery cycle, I mean, the full cycle, Shiva? Maybe at that time.
Sure. Okay, now, sorry.
Yeah. So I think basically Shravan's question, in a way, even I had that question. I thought of parking it until we go there. So basically, we are just trying to get aligned with the current process, what we are seeing here, where the system proposes the packaging, as Shravan said, based on the packaging instruction and determination. However, that gets overwritten with the handling units, which we are picking for the delivery. We have the customized module, which I mentioned in the first session, that which helps update the delivery with the handling units. Handling units are nothing but the serial numbers that we use on individual boxes or the pallets. So the way how they are packed, the same information will be flown into handling units. That's how it is. So we are just trying to compare and just trying to understand how we can leverage EWM to have a similar kind of updation.
Okay. So now here it's pretty simple. You scan the input HU, the one which was brought by the picker, and then change here by pressing the button change, and then select the box, you know, whether whichever box you want, small carton, medium carton, extra large, and other things. Then, as I said, the right side, you know, the things are moved, and there you can capture the weight, and you know, if you want to unpack them specifically, you can do the unpacking and repacking. That's it, you know, these are the activities, just some step flow. And now the pack work center or the deco work center determination is done by the activity area. Now we are learning the third usage of the activity area. So the activity area, again, the we know the PPO, the put away path or pick path optimization, and also we know about the CLSP. Now this is the third usage of activity area, you know. When it comes to outbound, the work centers are dynamically determined. For example, whatever that it's picked here within these aisle number, 7 till 10, it's routed through pack work center 2. You know, similarly, the aisles 1 to 4, it would be routed through pack work center 1. So likewise, you know, we can have dedicated work centers catering to the zones or to the, you know, areas or a bunch of aisles. Similarly, on the inbound, we have the deco work center also determined based on the destination activity area. While picking, it is based on the source activity area. So the sales and destination activity area can be different. The same bins can be grouped and for different activity areas or different activities per se. Now, org elements, right? When it comes to the just an understanding, what's the picture in EWM? The terminologies are different. You know, you call it plant over there and location, customer vendor called as BP. Material master called as product master, just a terminology, but you know, you call it supply chain, you know, global terms all looks really interesting. Okay, these are pretty much supply chain terms or network focused terms. These are pretty much enterprise focused terms, you know, or within the four walls. So here the plant and shipping point for classical customers, SIF, core interface, when they do, system creates a location and supply chain unit. customer vendor, it creates all three: location, supply chain unit, and BP, business partner. But we EWM, we don't really bother much on the location, except for some one-off, you know, route determination or some stuff. But basically, location is not our main focus. Or EWM, you know, more interested in supply chain unit because of the address information, and also the business partner BPs only. Location is more of, you know, APO relevant entity. Then the material master is called product master. And then we remember we have to enrich the material master, sorry, product master, and make it Varo's product master. So there is a difference between the product master and the Varo's product master. Product master means the global data which has been taken from ECC master. For example, ECC having 1,000 fields, we don't take all of them, you know, maybe 20 of them are relevant for EWM. So we just transfer the 20, maybe a reduced message, IDOC segments, and then we pull those 20 fields alone. And that is a global product master. And after that, you enhance the EWM specific fields, that becomes a Varo's product master. Any questions on this? It loosely says master data, but keep in mind there are org elements as well. So it's not to be, you know, literally taken out. This master data term is just a, just a term. On this slide, just pause for a few seconds. No? Okay. So when it comes to the classical EWM or the business suite, it's all core interface. And core interface is a big topic, right? You can just, if you're interested, or you know, you happen to be in a implementation, a classical EWM implementation, then you need to know a bit of CF, CIF also. There are transactions all the way from CFM1 to, you know, CFM7. So to schedule the job and to, you know, delete and update, some jobs has to run back to back. And the main question is like, are we doing a centralized approach or a decentralized approach? Meaning if there are 10 warehouses regionally spread across and, you know, globally spread across, is it like the central team is going to monitor the IDOC issues, or you know, it's all decentralized? So accordingly, you determine, you know, how many models needs to be created. At least, you know, you need from the function point of view, you know, planned shipping points, which normally happens very rarely. Maybe, you know, once in 3 months or once in 6 months, or even the planned creation is very not that frequent. So you need to do an explicit push also. Maybe there is no need to run this model. Maybe the material model may be running once in a week or twice in a week. Batch may be running daily, maybe daily twice also. And then the batch classification and characteristics, customer vendor, all going through the core interface. A core interface, again, you know, technically speaking, it's a QRFC only. Any questions on classical world? Then the S4 decentral, right? Here we moved back to IDOCs, right? We are no more using a core interface. So SAP has switched back to IDOC. Now IDOC is the way forward for decentral. Anyway, you know, embedded customer life is easy. The material, the master data is available straight away. You know, there is no pain. So here a material transferred through the IDOCs, batch all through IDOCs, except for packing instructions. I don't know why this is you know, still an odd man out. Just in case, if you are creating the pack instructions in the core system and then transferring them, you got to do. But I have rarely seen this, you know, thing. There is an upload file available in EWM, same like your bin upload or sorting upload. Similar to that, there is a pack specs upload also in EWM. So we used to use that file and upload the pack specs. But just in case, you know, imagine that the same pack specs being used by other stakeholders like APO or, you know, SNC, then maybe it's required to, you know, maintain the central system and then distribute them. Okay, that's just keep in mind, SIF, remaining all IDOCs. And IDOCs, SAP has simplified the job. They are giving some nice reports. If you run the report, or, you know, sort of it will set up the partner profile, and also with the reduced message segments. Whichever fields that are relevant for EWM, both in the material master and the credit and debit master, meaning the customer and vendor master. So those reduced segments are already there. But if you have some additional, you know, custom fields, then we need to, you know, modify those segments. Clinically, we have to do that. But just keep in mind, the reports would be handy if you don't have the expertise in setting up the partner profile and the message reductions and blah, blah, blah. Then we can just basically use those reports to hit the ground running. And plant, you know, the plant is like, there's no mechanism. So you got to create the supply chain unit manually in EWM. Any questions on this slide? No? Okay. So embedded EWM, there is no issue at all, right? The master data is instantly available. The moment the plant is there, supply chain unit is created by the wizard, and the BP, it's there, I think, the vendor master, customer master, BP is created if you do the mapping. And the wizard is creating the supply chain unit, or you create it manually. Either way, the supply chain unit is the only thing. The batch creation is immediate. The classification characteristics, all are available, you know, only for the pack specs. It's still there. Now, this no core interface, nothing, right? All the harmonized tables, the series redirect views, these things are all, you know, S4HANA philosophies. Okay. Now, multi-client warehousing, we talked about it, right? I'll just give an example. Let's take the Bax Global, right? The Bax Global is a LSP, especially in Malaysia or in this Southeast Asia region. Let's say he's handling, you know, three high-tech customers like Intel, Samsung, and AMD, maybe. Okay. So these are called the PED, party entitled to dispose. Now, let's say the customer client or, you know, plant equals to PED equals to owner of goods, you know, then this is a normal scenario. Everything is same, but only some exceptional scenario, assuming, you know, the AMD's vendor is directly placing the stocks at Bax Global as a consignment stock. In that case, the owner is AMD vendor, you know. Otherwise, the owner, the PED, the plant, the client, all are the people whom the 3PL is dealing with, you know, so-called clients. Now, this is the custodian. Clear? So this warehouse, when we maintain the product master, we maintain it for the combination of warehouse number and PED. PED is nothing but the plant as the BP. Okay, for this combination, we maintain the EWM specific attributes. Like we maintain the accounting view at the plant level, and, you know, sales view at the sales area level. So likewise, we maintain the warehouse product view, the combination of warehouse number and PED. Why these two combinations? Because they could be single plant multi-warehouse or multi-plant single warehouse. So for that reason, we maintain it specifically for a given combination. And, you know, the custodian and, you know, a thing is assigned here. And custodian is just the plant code. If really, you know, if not the 3PL, but still the custodian is a custodian. And a supply chain unit, you know, there is a mandatory need to assign to the warehouse number. And these things are default only. If there are multiple plants pointing to one warehouse, and let's say, you know, 80% of the time you would be transacting in one of the plant, or 90% of the time, then you can make that plant as a default one, so that, you know, it will minimize the entry over here. Any questions on this understanding? Customer, PED, owner, three things only: customer, owner, and PED. Manish, Govind, Shravan, no, Shiva, right. So the product master and warehouse product master, which we talked about, right? The global data is the one immediately after SIFIN or after the IDOC transfer. It's called the global data. It's also product master. And in the master, you see the hat symbol. Wherever you see the hat symbol, the header symbol, that means the global data. And there are three tabs for EWM, you know, the warehouse data tab, slotting tab, and storage type data. Like we have the WM1 view and WM2 view, similar to that, you know, WM1 view, this could be WM2 view. Okay, now the important things are the put away control indicator, the section indicator, and bin type, and also the removal indicator. we have one indicator for cycle counting process, like ABC based on the velocity. Also, this PTDI, the process type determination indicator, is an important one, which will help you to determine the WPT, you know, the warehouse process type. And there is a dedicated tab for slotting to pull the demand data or the, you know, basically the demand data from SOP or APO. And also there could be some recommended storage quantity and dimensions of maintained year if you're not using HU. And in the storage type data, we maintain data specific to the storage type, especially for the fixed bin storage or the peak phase locations, wherein you maintain the number of maximum number of bins, you know, section indicator. The section indicator maintained year is more specific, and the one maintained year is a generic one. And most importantly, here we maintain the replenishment data, like the minimum value, minimum quantity, maximum quantity for replenishment purpose. You know, remember the kitchen, the spice example I gave. So for any fixed bin, you maintain the minimum quantity. So once it goes below, the stock gets depleted below the minimum quantity, a replenishment is triggered. Any questions on this? And these are the data, you know, important data also, storage data. In addition to this, there are some more tabs which pulls the very basic information like the material group, the product hierarchy, of course the unit of measure and shelf life parameters. But this tab is the important tab wherein we have some grouping, you know, various product group and storage conditions, and these are pretty much used in the slotting, and some are serial number, catch weight, functionality, you know. So at this point in time, if you know these critical fields, it'd be good. Now, if I show the product master.
So for technical purpose, we are creating one WM also, right? For EWM purpose, for material master, right?
Technical purpose, we are creating WM.
So one WM is required for EWM, right? You are creating the one WM, warehouse?
Warehouse view? No, warehouse view is not required, right? The ECC two views are not applicable for EWM. EWM, we have two more views, you know, one for packaging material, the other one is a regular view, and that view is EWM specific. Whatever data we maintain over there, it will flow to this tab, you know, the global data tab, which is your storage tab. Let me show you. I think I don't have the picture. Let me but show it in the system.
No, when we are discussing it, so for technical purpose, one warehouse is required for EWM, right? So that's the reason I'm asking, do we need the, all the materials to be extended to WM also?
He means intermediate.
Yeah, yes, right. Intermediate warehouses.
Not required. Now I got your point, intermediate. So you're looking at intermediate. So if you go to MM01, right? Normally what happens, let me try to extend, you know, for this. So normally you have these two views, right? WM1 and 2. These two are ECC. So these two totally no business for EWM. Let's be clear, right? Okay. No relevance at all. This is gone. You know, with the ECC, WM only, these two are gone. So just that I'm showing, you know, for comparison purpose. Otherwise, you know, I can deactivate the views. This view has no business in EWM. Okay. Now these are the two views for which we need to maintain the screen sequence and other things. Let's not worry much on the packaging view. This is only for the packaging materials, right? Let's focus on the only view, WM execution view. And this view is a material already maintained. So when I just go there, material change immediately, right? This view is a plant level view only, okay? It's nothing to do with any intermediate warehouse or anything. Okay, so here these indicators like handling indicator, material group, storage condition, these are the ones which you see in EWM. So if you go to mat one, this is an EWM product master or warehouse product master, right? So what is the difference? These are symbol, right? The hat symbol. These are the product master or the global data. And for EWM, we have these three views: warehouse data, slotting, and storage type. So whatever we do it in ECC over here in the execution view, you know, as a central MDG system or, you know, central maintenance, that flows here to the storage depth, you know. So you see product group, storage condition, pilferable indicator, all these are here. Product group, material group, storage condition, pilferable indicator. There are a few fields, but there are some workarounds or, you know, some notes which talks about that. You see the destination, you have more fields, whereas the source has few fields, you know. So this is what. So there's no need for WM. Was it Shravan again or was it?
Yes, Rajan.
Clear now?
Rajan, one quick, what is the business reason of maintaining this WM execution in the ECC or in the S4 core material master?
Because it's central system, right? WM execution, this global data needs to be maintained over there only. It's not recommended to do it locally here. It's even if it's going there, it's grayed out, you know. Central maintenance, it's not advisable to do maintenance locally, you know. It has to come from the origin or source system.
WM execution also, we'll have to maintain it at plant level only. It is not at a warehouse, EWM warehouse level.
Yeah, warehouse level, no. These are global data, you see. And this will not be warehouse specific also. At the end of the day, these are grouping fields, you know, like how you handling indicator. You can't have different views for different, you know, warehouses. These are very generic fields only, you know. Yeah, but the real crux is your the warehouse specific data is here, you know. The put away indicator, the section indicator, the bin type, the bulk stacking indicator, or, you know, if you see these indicators are pretty much there in the WM one view, comparable, you know. So if you compare with ECC WM, not maintained. Okay, let me just maintain it here in the MM01. Right, so the put away is called placement indicator. The removal indicator is removal indicator, you see. The passy put away control indicator, it's your stock placement. Similarly, the removal indicator is your removal indicator. And then the section indicator and bin type, here you see section indicator. And bulk storage indicator is there, you know. Two-step picking indicator is also there, two-step picking. And bulk stacking indicator is there, okay. So it's whatever we do it in the ECC WM1 view, similar thing we are doing it here, you know. And also whatever we do it here, WM2, maybe it's not here, you know, storage type level I got to show, but the data, right, the minimum quantity, the maximum quantity, replenishment quantity, all that information are maintained here. For example, whenever the minimum quantity is 48, going less than 4 cartons, or trigger a replenishment, you know, to bring 2 pallet load, assuming 192 is 1 pallet, so bringing through 2 pallet load. Whenever the stock goes below 4 cartons, you know, and the movement has to be happen in multiples of cartons only, just in case, you know, we don't want to make the poor operator, you know, break the cartons, and, you know, we want to align with the carton quantity. So this is called a rounding or minimum replenishment quantity. And here we maintain some max number of fixed bins. For example, you don't want one single product to be super dominant and going and, you know, grabbing more number of bins. So just putting a lid on that, we have the max number of bins. So these two views are quite important, the warehouse data view and storage type data view. And slotting is the one wherein you can pull the demand quantity or the sales order line items or the company policy, you know, for a given SKU, how much is the recommended storage quantity based on the planning tools, and all the dimensions are maintained here. And when the last slotting happened, you know, when the slotting run happened, it stores the timestamp. All right, that's a product master. And just keep in mind, the product master can be maintained individually using this transaction MAT1. Else, we can do it from the monitor. So from the monitor also, we can do. And as part of the go live, you should have some mechanism, you know, custom program or a migration program, SAP, you know, migration program. For uploading the product master or the material master, you know, because when you do the IDOC, you get the global data, but EWM attributes, you need to have sufficient tool. If it's just a 10,000 or 5,000 material, not a problem, you know, you can do it here. You can just maintain the attributes, the warehouse view and then the storage type view, you can do mass maintenance. But if it's a huge number of material, you know, running into 40,000 or 80,000 or, you know, 1 million, then you need a tool. So any questions on the product master understanding? What about you guys, the freshers, Chandru, Saurav, following all, Swarna?
Yes, Rajan.
Yes. Okay, excellent.
Rajan, on this last part, the packaging instruction flowing into EWM as packaging spec. So is the structure, everything, it's going to be the same or?
It's going to be same, I guess. Yeah, I never, you know, seen this kind of flow, but they are calling something called IPP, the Integrated Process and Product Engineering. You know, somewhere they maintain the pack specs, and that's the central maintenance.
Okay.
And there is something called Unified Package Builder also. You know, these are new things, and that is part of the MIGO. You know, the synchronous receiving can either use the POP one or the POP one in the ECC. Or the pack specs in EWM, or it can have a unified view, you know, so it's called a unified package builder. So which has been taken from the TM module. But this instruction, honestly speaking, I never seen the stuff in ECC, whether it's how the structure looks like and other things. So I would assume that, you know, it's a similar structure. It's coming through core interface. But normally we used to upload directly in EWM. There's an upload program. So we get the file and if required, maybe an ABAP program to decode or, you know, provide us the first cut or refinement and then we upload them. So it's quite complex, especially when you have a 3-level or 4-level. But if it's just 1-level, it's okay. Now.
Rajan, sorry. In the previous slide, there is a packing instruction and and it's mapped to SCM packing specifications. I think this is what Sravan asked, I believe. Can you brief on this point, the last packing instruction, CEF and SCM?
I told you, no, I'm not, I use the POP and other things to pack, but I'm not sure whether this is the pack instruction or really, you know, something else. Are they talking about this? I assume this is, you know, the ones which we maintain in the transaction POP, you know, which is called the pack instruction, because that's the one we refer to pack instruction. Okay. So that hierarchy, you know, may be flowing to EWM and creates a pack specs, meaning the hierarchy is similar, you know, whether you call it 0-level, 1-level, 2-level, similar hierarchy is there in EWM also. And it can be sifted so that, you know, whatever the pack instructions that are maintained in ECC can be converted into pack specs in EWM.
So the packing specification can be used for automatic packing.
Of course, that's the main usage. You know, pack specs is not only auto packing, it's used for most of the scenarios in EWM, like picking tasks, slotting, deconsolidation, pick issue proposal. The pack specification and, you know, activity area, wide usage in EWM. Yeah, extensive usage in EWM. So you will learn about, I'm just going to the pack specs only next, just keep your, you know, gunpowder, we'll just next time, and next topic I'm going there only, we'll see. Okay, this is all quick slides, you know, I'm just running through the product master, same story again and again and again, we are talking SIF and IDOC, and the EWM S4HANA embedded, all the advantage, you know, the DB, TCO, blah, 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 all the advantage simplified. Pack spec. Before going to the pack specs, let me just go through the other things. Business partner, again, the same thing, SIF and IDOC. But just keep in mind, when you're doing a decentral S4HANA, you just need to do some bit of mapping, so-called CVA mapping or something, right? If you watched here, you might have picked the signal, you know, here you see the CVA. So you just need to do a bit of more configuration, you know, settings. To do the customer vendor account group mapping in terms of internal, external, blah, 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 number ranges, you know, this is slightly tricky. So, yeah, again, it's not my strong area, I would say. But just you follow the guide, integration guide, then you can do that. Now, coming back to this other topics, business partners is clear. Now, there are some other things also moving. It's just not the product or the business partners, but also dangerous goods and hazardous substance master and something called phrases also moved through the IDOC ALE or through the SIF, you know, for the EHS module, the environment, health and safety module, and some phrases function modules. Then the price needs to be moved to EWM. So there are some special RFCs which you can pull the price information to EWM. And also the another table to store the price plus the GUI ID for split valuation materials, you know. So this price is required for tolerance check when you do the physical inventory. For example, if the tolerance is less than $500, maybe it goes to the supervisor. If it's more than 500, it goes to the manager, you know, something like that. So for that, EWM needs the price. Otherwise, EWM is purely, you know, deals with the quantities only. Variety of quantities. Split valuation also, we store them in a different table, the two different prices, one the imported one, maybe the other one domestic price. So for that reason, we are pulling the price from ECC. Also, we pull the account information, the accounting objects like the work center, the cost center, and then the WBS and things for issuing to internal customers or, you know, issuing to these cost elements. Okay, with that, I am done. Now let's move on to the last one, the pack specs. Okay, the pack specs. So packaging specification, again, we call it pack specs, like the put away control indicator, we say PASI. Just go through the acronym so that you learn these terms and, you know, maybe, yeah, it will help just to, not to speak continuously. Pack specs, okay, we have the things, header and then the contents and then level. For each level, we have an element group, and then underneath we have the elements. Actually, the elements can be basically of two types only, either the packaging material or the auxiliary packaging material. You know, for example, level one could be an inner pack, and level two could be an outer pack. Level N could be a pallet level. You know, finally at the floor level. So the pack specs again, it uses condition technique. Whenever I say condition technique, you guys might be quite familiar, especially the SD guys, the pricing techniques or, you know, the output determination, all are condition techniques only in SAP. For the freshers, you know, you might have to Google and, you know, get some nice documents in the internet or, you know, or from your, you know, seniors, and then go through these condition techniques. So essentially it is having a procedure, and if you go from the top down, then it's a procedure, and then it has a condition type, and it has multiple, you know, access sequence. Finally, the condition tables are maintained with the records. So for example, you know, we want to go with the very specific one to the generic one, you know, for a combination of maybe a customer or route or, you know, supply chain ID. If the record is not found, then it may be looking for just a ship to party. If nothing is there, then it will take from the warehouse number level, something like that. A very detailed one to the generic one, you know, system will look for the condition records, matching records. So that's about condition technique. And keep in mind, the pack specs uses condition technique to determine the record. And as I said, the pack specs is very extensively used in EWM. And EWM, I would say, this is the major, you know, consumer of the pack specs. Ideally speaking, this is the second number, IPPE, Integrated Process and Product Engineering. That's where the pack specs is maintained centrally and distributed to the peripheral systems like SNC, EWM, the IBP. Let's say EWM, okay? We have several usages, the auto HU creation during inbound or the palletization data, you know, during the put-away task or removal task. Even slotting looks at the packaging data, the pack specs. For warehouse order, we talked about the pick HU. When you are going for picking, whether how many cartons or how many totes you need to, you know, do as a preparatory step, put them on the cart before going for picking, you know, those pick HU proposals also are done by these pack specs only. Okay. Now let's go one by one. Use case one. Assuming the vendor is not providing the labels and you receive three pallet loads, for example, one carton 25 each is, and one pallet four cartons. So you got to print 12 cotton labels and also, sorry, 12 cotton labels and three pallet labels. By click of a button or by doing the auto packing using the condition type called 0IBD, you can get instantly 15 labels, you know. So it will speed up the receiving activities. So there is no bottleneck. The labels can be slapped on the carton and then the receiving activities can be, you know, expedited. Then zero pal can be compared with your LE quantity, the loading equipment quantity in ECCWM. So whenever you create a task, you need to mirror with the real world objects. For example, if I am moving two bags or two cartons, wherein I want two tasks to be created, even though you don't use HU management, still you can leverage on this zero pal and create the tasks to mimic the real world objects rather than, you know, creating something randomly and then forcing the operator to do the split. It's unwarranted. And there are zero WHT, which happens during task creation. So zero IBD can happen. Either you can press the button icon, red color, you know, pack icon, or it can happen automatically when the delivery is replicated to EWM. Zero PAL is triggered during task creation, and this zero WHT, obviously it gets triggered during task creation. The example here is the 27 metric ton. Normally the polymer world, the Reliance, you know, they go with the customer orders comes for 27 metric ton, a full truck load. And each pallet is 1 metric ton, you know, polymer, polyester, polypropylene, whatever you call it, you know, rubber. So 1 metric ton, one pallet, with 27 pallets that needs to be loaded. Instead of creating one task for 27 metric ton and getting stuck with one operator, it makes sense to create 27 tasks, you know, based on the packaging actual pallet data. You know, for that, we can leverage the pack specs and create 27 tasks rather than one WT, getting stuck with the operator and multiple resources or multiple forklifts can go and grab the pallets, you know, one at a time. So here we talk about the same famous example, the 111, 100 being pallet, 10 being carton and one being each, three different picking areas. The delivery line would be splitted into three different pick tasks taken from three different storage types maybe. You know, so for that reason, we are using the pack specs with quantity classification. QC is quantity classified. When we say quantity classified picking, the 111 should come in your mind. Quantity classified, a disciplined or organized storage, pallets are stored in pallet storage, carton, each storage, you know, individual storage. So we are okay in sort of diluting the FIFO, but still our main priority or main goal is to do an optimized picking. You don't want to create more partials and, you know, create more chaos in the warehouse. So one more example of the use case for the pack specs is a zero BDL, which happens during the WO creation, or these pick HUs are assigned to the warehouse order, not to the tasks, you know. At the warehouse order level, the operator needs to know how many totes I have to pick before doing the picking. I need to arrange or, you know, prepare on the trolley or the cart. So there are two algorithms, simple algorithm and complex algorithm. Simple one assumes that your warehouse is only using one blue tote, you know, of one size only. So based on the quantity or weight being picked, the system is smart enough to suggest saying that, hey, go with, you know, two plastic totes or three totes. It will just do the split once the weight is reached or the volume is reached. Whereas the complex algorithm means assuming in your warehouse you're having multiple cartons of different sizes, medium, large, small cartons, then it can suggest the desired carton dynamically. You know, for example, if you're picking 100, it says, hey, go with carton A or large carton. If you're picking 50 each, it might propose a smaller carton. Like you go to the sweet shop and you go buy 200 grams, you know, you get a small box. Maybe if you buy 1 kilo, you get a big box. Understood the usages of pack specs. Now, are there any questions, Shravan?
That WT is what a weight,
one warehouse task.
Warehouse task. So, basing on the weight, also can we determine that number of boxes or something like that?
Yeah, the weight of the based on the weight, also you can the pick issues can be suggested. zero BDL procedure, right? For example, if you are picking 75 kilogram, only 20 can be placed on a box, then it will say go with four boxes. Based on the weight, based on the volume, based on the alternate unit of measure. Mm-hmm. Any questions on the pack specs?
Now, okay. To add that Sravan's questions, so it will suggest to take the same packing material with multiple units, or it will suggest altogether different packing material. For example, if
you said right, if you are implementing simple algorithm, that mm-hmm. means it's the same box T1 only you're having, you know, tote number one tote mm-hmm. only, one kind of tote only. So it will just suggest as many numbers, you know, based on the weight or volume being picked, or the widgets being picked, number of widgets being picked. But if you are using complex algorithm, that means you are having variety of boxes, like the sweet shop, you know.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So there are more usages. Slot. Okay. Yeah. Go ahead.
Instead of carton, it can suggest something else. The big steel box or something like that. If the weight is
anything, you know, all that are packaging material only. It need not be carton, you know. It could be anything. All big HUs only or ship HUs only. Yeah. So wide usage, you know, slotting, deco, cartonization, planning, crate part staging, blah blah blah. You know, so it's a pack specs is a huge topic. I don't know whether the pack instruction has these many features or, you know, that's why it's better to give the control to the EWM pack specs. Packaging using the pack instructions, and normally we do it when we do the packing in ECC. But if the vendor is sending the ASN, then there is no need to do the packing, right? So where is the question of using the pack instruction?
One second,
I'm just thinking.
Rajan, yeah. One more. So we maintain some kind of packing instructions, which will be there in the delivery. So will
the outbound delivery?
Yes. So that instructions will be there.
Instructions are just a text or
text. The text will be there. So that
text is just a passed, right? The text as part of the text profile, you can pass the text to the EWM system, you know. And this text will appear in the work center or during pick-in.
Okay.
When you're just talking about the instruction as a text, that's a different thing. But here we are talking about the packing as a function, not as a text.
No, I got it. No, just checking. That's okay.
And Rajan, this pack specs, at what all levels, means what all combinations we can maintain?
It's a condition technique, you know, it's a free world. You want to maintain for any combination, for example, based on the source zone or, you know, ship to party, you know, route, or based on the, you know, carrier or vendor. You can build your flexible things, actually, you know, from the catalog, field catalog.
Okay, so it's wide open.
It's wide open and it's widely triggered. It's just like, you know, like it can be triggered during WO creation, during task creation, or during the delivery replication. You know, just keep in mind these are the three important, you know, triggers, I would say. But the condition technique is a framework, you know, flexible framework. Yeah. Good. Now,
Rajan, sorry, one last question. Yeah. For inbound scenario, right? You mentioned OIBD is the condition.
Zero,
right?
IBD, yeah,
correct. So, zero IBD. So if my vendor sends the packaging or the handling units through a desired AVI doc, so the inbound delivery, the moment it is created, we will have the handling units, right? It is packed and we'll have the handling units. And during the distribution to EWM, the same handling units will also be transferred to EWM.
To EWM, correct. Yeah.
Yeah. And in that case, we don't need any pack specification, is what I am assuming. Is that correct?
You may be needing pack specification for maybe picking or, you know, for some other purpose, but not for zero IBD. Yeah.
Yeah, got it. Yeah.
Zero IBD is only required if the I showed you the example, right? We need to print and paste the labels, you know, as part of receiving.
Where vendor is not sending. Okay.
Vendor is not sending. So that case, zero IBD would be handy, especially for a desktop transaction. And if you're talking about a nested HU and then you are, you know, going to the carton level label pasting, then it makes sense to tap on zero IBD.
Okay.
If it's just a pallet, you can construct on the fly, you know, in a mobile device and give them a mobile printer, and then, you know, they will get the label. Not a big deal. So a quick a final, you know, thing categorization. This is again not a sacrosanct; it's debatable. You know, we are not getting into any further things like master data and org elements. Sometimes there's a thin line. So now you see the LE elements, the logistics execution elements, plan, store, location, shipping points are relevant for us. EWM elements are the warehouse number, storage type, section, and activity area, and physical inventory area, which we have not covered. But remaining things we have covered. Supply chain unit is dicey. You know, you say it's an org element or a master data. I don't want to, you know, I'm okay, whatever we say. Master data, here we say material master, product master, and warehouse product master. You should be able to differentiate between the three. The ECC one is the material master, and global data, the moment after the SIF or the IDOC, it's called product master. And after you enrich the EWM specific data, it's called the warehouse product master. And the storage bins is the master data. Even though we create a template and other things as a master data, business partners, work centers, pack specs, routes, no? Other master data, packaging material, resource master, like the forklifts or, you know, the reach trucks or the turret stock pickers. Then the production supply area bins, transportation routes or lanes. I don't know why it's coming here and there. Okay, anyway covered. So ignore this. Material price information, accounting objects and inspection rules. So these are the master data and, you know, the org elements on the left-hand side. Okay, with that, I'm done. The exercises 7, 8, 9 are pending. Work center setup and then the product master verification is like a Bible. I frequently go and do it. I will not maintain in one shot. As in when I do the scenarios, I will go and maintain the product master. So that's exercise number 8. And 9 is pack specs maintenance. 6 is pending, activity area. 5 is done, which is our storage bin, right? So what's the time check? 11:40. Let's have a quick summary only today. Yeah, any questions? Because I'm going to do these exercises. Just try one or two. I'll not have the time to complete all of them. So, okay. Just keep asking me, you know, while I open the SAP system. Okay, so now let's create the activity area, right? So step number 5 completed, the bin master. So step number 6 is exercise number 6 is activity area. So just go here, EWM master data, activity areas, define activity area. So let me see if EW17, I have the RKG1 or RKG2. Okay, it's not there. So I just copy it from EW07, RKG1, where is RKG1? RKG1, RKG2, and also I need one generic activity area for picking, which is AARK. So 2 for put away and 1 for pick in. I'm just copying them and then just doing it for my warehouse. Done. So 3 activity areas, 2 for put away and 1 for pick in, right? If you want, you can change the group description. Done. June, TCS batch, then assign bins to the activity area. The next thing. All right, now assign bins to the activity area. I'm just going sequentially, you know. So here again, I'm pulling, in this case, I'm just using the expert mode and then say, warehouse number, EW07, and then append, and then I select the activity areas, activity area. Okay, RKG1. Just one at a time we'll do. Okay, RKG1, it has a 1 to 4 aisle, and aisle number 5, I don't know why it's repeated twice. Maybe not required. Okay, just I copy this 2 only, and then I just do it for my warehouse, EW17. For time being, I'm not sure about the number range for the consolidation group, so I remove it, and then, so aisle number 1 to 4 is, RKG1. And aisle number 5 is RKG2. As usual, I remove this. And this just says that it's a special aisle, you know, SP. Okay. So I have these two aisles created. 1 to 4 is RKG1, and then the aisle number 5 is a special aisle, which I'm using this bin section attribute, you know. So I'm just going to make a 2 copies and create RKG2, which is aisle number 7 to 11. Okay, that's a default aisle. And then also RKG2, aisle number 6 is again special aisle. Okay, and this is special. Okay, done. So we have 4 sequence for 2 activity areas. So if you see, we have selection by contents, EW17, RKG1, append, activity area, show me, or RKG2. All right. Oh my God, it's gone. Anyway, let's not EW17. And what is this? It's not sensing it. Okay, RKG1. And what about RKG2? It's there, all there. So, okay, RKG1, I have sequence number 1, 1, and then 2, 3. Sorry, 1 and 2, 1 and 2. Oh my God, it's 3 things I have created wrongly. Okay, there is a mistake. Just get this field also to the front. Okay, so 1 and 4, good. And then aisle number 5 is again incorrectly done. So this is a mistake. I should do it for RKG1. All right, so now I can delete this. Okay, now I can just pull the deco group. I select all the 4 records and then I go inside and then I pull the deconsolidation group. Change the numbering requires a resorting. It's okay. Okay, no problem. I will do the resorting. Okay, pull the deco group. Okay, done. So many pop-ups. Okay, 3 records done. Last one. What is this? Endless loop. Okay, done. Stupidity will do. Okay, so we have numbers 1, 0, 7, 0, 7, 1, 7, 2, 7, 3 done. 2 are special aisles and 1 is a default aisle. So let's just go back to our layout thing, right? So there I have my thing opened here. Just give me a second. I'm no longer has access to the chat, Subhash. Okay, I'm just unsharing. Just give me a second. All right, let me just go there and hang on. Okay, right, so here you go, sharing the screen now. So this is the one, right? You need to frequently refer to. I don't know whether I shared this with the Akash. If not, I'll share it. So this is what, you know, the RKG1 is aisle 1 to 5. And aisle 5 is a special aisle, right? And then these are the things we did, right? We got 300 bins. And, you know, right, aisle 1 to 10 only, not 11. So 1 to 10. And 6 stacks are there. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 stacks, and then the level we have up to E, you know, and just keep this layout in mind, you know, so that we know what we are doing when it comes to the scenarios, you know. So why these 5 and 6 are special aisles? Because we store some, you know, various cages and some tall pallets, and that's why the bin type is different, you know, PAL2. Over there, it's a regular pallet, and these are special pallets or, you know, various cages, and also this gray zone. That's why, you know, it's a separate sequence. with the consolidation group. Meaning if you receive a mixed HU, two products, one product going to white zone, the other one going to gray zone, within this yellow zone, you know, in that case, it will be routed via Deco Work Center, or DEW1. Okay, with that, I'm pretty much done with exercise number six. So now I move on to the seventh one, which is Work Center. So we're going to create two work centers, Deco 1 and Deco 2, and then and one more work center for the expedite packing. So two work centers for deconsolidation and one for outbound packing. And then we marry the bin and, you know, blah, blah, blah. So let me just complete this and then I'm done for today. How to create two works.
Rajan, sorry to cut you. One question on activity areas. So when you are assigning that storage bins to activity areas, right, in this configuration, so it's all based on aisle and stack and level, right?
And controls, flexible controls are there, you know.
Yeah, but when we discussed like about a freely created bins, like not using that sequence, that without that structure, so how can we group the bins?
So for example, here we have flexibility, aisle start, aisle end, stack start, level start, you know, and also the bin section, start end. When it comes to the free ones, right, here, I forgot to do that. These are the ones, you know, intermediate, so type section bin you can give directly.
Okay,
these three fields would be used for interim ones, you know, all the interim ones. So now I'm good that you reminded me, you know, so I forgot to do one more step, config step. So now you're learning, you know, the activity area is quite important config. My God. The problem with this, actually, you know, we take a lease server, and even though we pay money for 2-3 years, it shows us ugly head. Where are we? What are we doing? Maybe some lock entries. So just go and check some lock entries if it is there. No. Good. Okay, the last config I missed out, you know, master data, activity areas, define done, ascend done, then the sort sequence, okay? So this is where we can play, you know, ascending, descending, alternating, you know, aisle, inward aisle, outward aisle, all that we can do to get a sort number. So I'm going to, what is it? My warehouse, EW07 is my template warehouse, RKG1, right? So I can just use it for put away. I can just copy this too. The sequence number matters, you know. You can't just have a different sequence. Please ensure that the corresponding sequence number, you know, what we did in the earlier step, that should match. So now I just say 17 and RKG put away 1. In this case, I am giving preference to stack first, then level, then subdivision. Anyway, I don't have a subdivision, so. But subdivision is just, you know, tagging along with this. Three elements are together, so. We have all possible combinations, you know, whether to give subdivision preference and then level stack, or subdivision stack and level. So this would be real good, you know, subdivision stack and level. Nothing good or bad, you know, it depends on the requirement. So aisle again, you know, this is an inward aisle ascending, maybe an outward aisle descending. So stack ascending, aisle ascending, I'm not sure. Stack ascending, I can appreciate. Aisle direction ascending, stack ascending, descending, then alternating, you know. Odd men on the left hand side and the even bins on the right hand side. So all that we can do, you know, it just hands on only how much you practice and you know, keep sorting them to get the desired results. So if it's not happening, then you just upload an Excel file. So now I just create the sorting default one for my warehouse, EW17, two records copied, and then I just do it for RKG2 also. For putaway activity, you know, whenever we say it's specifically for activity. So done, four records created. Now one required for picking. So picking, I'm not sure whether I did the previous step. For the time being, I'm not worried on the picking. So anyway, put away and picking all needs to be completed in exercise number 6. So done. Let me just go and do the sorting and see if it's working or not. So I just go to the transaction SBST bin sort and then give it a shot for RKG1. Nothing happening. Activity area. No data found for RKG1 and activity in various content. Okay. So what I did, RKG1 done, right? The EW17. RKG1, then 1 to 4, 5 to 7, 7 to 10. It's all there. 6 put away. Did we create the bins? Yes, we created the bins in 17 warehouse. These activity areas are there. I'll start an island. It's all good. But I need to assign them to the aisle, right? So that's a mistake. I need to do some messaging. I go to LS11 because we made a structural change, the config change. So our bin master should reflect the change also. So I just go to RKG and maybe I open the dynamic selection and I just press enter. And I say, show me the aisle numbers 1 to aisle number 1 to 4. Apply. No, it says 1 to 4. Right. So the aisle numbers 1 to 4 are default aisle. The bin section should be default. So I just say aisle number 1 to 4. Fast and slow are okay because the slow are the D and E, but these are all of PAL 1 bin type only. So two things I got to change. So I go change the bin type to PAL 1 white zone, and also the bin section as default one, default aisle. That's it. Get done. So 120 bins, not 120, maybe 120 bins changed. 1 to 4. Why I did for 1 to 4? Yeah, because the aisle number 5 is again, I just need to do for 7 to. I'm getting confused now. Let's go one more time. The special aisles are 5 and 6. 5 to 6 is a special aisle, right? Apply. What is this? X mark. Okay, 5 and 6. These are PAL 2 bin type for sure. PAL 2. And also these are special aisle SP. Okay, done. 180, and this should be 60. Whatever, 240 plus 60. Yeah, understood. But we did for 120 only, meaning 1 to 4 we did. Now we have to do the second tranche. Second tranche is 7 to 11.
6 to
6 is a special one, right? So 7 to 10. Yeah. 7 to 10. Okay, 7 to 10 I do. And 7 to 10, just in case if there is anything, let make it PAL 1. And the bin section is default one. That's it. This again 120 bins. So totally we should have 240 default ones and 60, All right, so done. So after doing the structural change, we need to align the bin master also, because bin is a master data. So whenever we do the config change, the bin master should reflect the change as well, whatever with regards to the activity, because this bin section setting is not part of the bin template. So that is part of the activity area. Now I can do the sorting, SPST. Okay, just try RKG1 and execute. So it's showing me. So this bin number 1 is going by stack, and then it's going to level, right? First it's giving preference to stack and then the level. So the sort number is stored in one of the table. At the end of the day, this sort number is used for put away. Whenever you do the put away, the sort number would be suggested. Similarly for picking activity, if you have done the sorting, the system would be suggesting this bin in that sequence number, especially in a mobile device confirmation. Okay, now I need to execute it here, done. And similarly, I do it for RKG2, done. So anytime if the supervisor, you know, wants some flexible control, they can delete and then they can resort, or they can do the file upload also, you know. When you do the file upload, that will overwrite the configuration settings. So any questions on this activity area sorting? If you go to the bin master, then you should be seeing the sort numbers, right? For example, if I go to LS03 and take any bin for that matter, TRKG 0101A, you see the activity areas sorted for put away activity and aisle number 11A. It's unfortunately not showing the sort number. The sort number is stored in a different table, you know. There's one more table to sort the sort number, to store the sort number. Okay. Are there any questions on the activity area exercise number 6? No. Let's continue with the deco. So I'm going to create a work center. Just give me 5 more minutes and then done. Work center. Define work center. So first, as I said, we got to create 3 work centers, deco 1 and deco 2. And also one work center for expedite packing. So deco 1, deco 2, and one expedite packing. Just copy them to my warehouse. Done. So what is so great about that? You know, you see here, we married that Y831. And for the remaining deco, we just add Y811, you know, storage type. And the sections, inbound section, outbound section, we talked about, right? The work center can be granularly mapped, the inbound area, the finished area, and the work in progress area. And the layout is quite important. You know, SAP has provided this layout, DKMX and VPMX. So let's see the layout, TCS batch. So now we have this layout, you know, that's where the programming controls are, you know, written. So here, broadly speaking, SAP has given this many layout considerations and the dedicated transaction also, the backend transaction. I'm not talking about the Fiori transactions. For example, packing outbound, packing inbound, deco, quality inspection, value-added services. For example, if you take the deco one and the quality one, maybe, okay, the deco, you activate the deco relevant one. See, deco is activated. Similarly, for the quality one, quality work center, we activate the quality inspection, you know, maybe the counting, cum quality inspection, maybe serial number, you know, provision to change the serial numbers. Yeah. So the information again, you know, you see whatever we see in the work center, there is a scanner area on the top right, and then the detailed area on the bottom right, and the different functions on the tree structure, you know. So that's how our work center is, you know, designed. See here, the work center, this is a work center transaction, right? The three parts, the tree structure, and then the top right, we have the scanning area, and the bottom right, we have the detailed area. So all the controls, which tabs needs to be shown for which function are controlled by this layout. Okay, so that's most important. The layout is important, and the transaction type is important. You have to select the correct transaction type. Especially when you're doing a multi-step put-away, POSC and LOSC, because these work centers will play a role when you're doing the multi-step put-away only as part of POSC. So now our layout is good to go. I'm done with the work center creation. And quickly, you know, if you want to review the storage type, you know, right, the work center should have the role E and 4x4 and blah, blah, blah. All that just for a quick recap. It's slow. So I'm going to just share the exercises until 8. So you can just practice whatever possible in this weekend, and then we are going to do 4 more exercises, setup exercises, and from exercise number 12 onwards, we can practice the scenarios. You know, so most likely by Monday we will start doing the scenarios. If not Monday, maybe Tuesday. Most likely I'm targeting Monday itself. Let's see. Now you see the work centers one last time, EW17, Y811. So the deco, see the role is E, and then, you know, HU mandatory, and then 4x4. All right. So now back to business. we are done with the work center, and we have the bins or not. You know? These people need to do something. Okay. Do we have the bins? So we have uploaded all the bins, right? So hopefully the bin should have been there. Let's just check Y811 and Y831. Y811 and Y831, the outbound packing and deco inbound. Okay, so we have the bins, inbound bin, outbound bin. For two different work centers, we have two different bins, deco one, deco two bin. Now I just need to marry the bin to the work center. So where is the transaction in easy access? Are you guys following with me? All good? Okay, we, Aditya. So this is the one, logistics, EWM, master data. Work centers. So here we define the attributes. So
Rajan, for one interim storage type, we can have multiple work centers. So depending upon the storage type, we will know it is at a decon center, but at the use by checking the storage bin, we will know which work center it is. It is there.
Right, the bin is finally assigned to the work center. Even one bin, can be assigned to multiple work centers also.
One bin. No.
With work center, we can play a lot of things actually. Yeah, it's a storage type, work center, and bin. You need to step back and digest. How these three work as a well-oiled machine for addressing multiple real-world scenarios, several real-world scenarios. So in my case, I am using only one storage type, as you rightly picked up the signal, Y811. Nevertheless, I have four different, bins, two work centers, four bins. For each work center, I have one inbound section and outbound section. So for deco one, I would just say outbound, So deco one out I will take, because I want to focus on the completed one only. So similarly, I do it for deco two out. Yeah, I don't bother about the in. In, I will show you, where the in is really coming into picture when we do the deco scenario. And similarly, I marry the pack work center bin, the expedite packing bin, done. So you may be asking, where is the terminal? Double click, you can just give the terminal name or the IP address and the pack material, the most frequently used pack material, scale interface, the RFC interface, and then the tolerance you can maintain. So with that, I'm done with the, so first we define the storage type and we create a work center and we assign the storage type to the work center. And finally, we assign the bin to the work center. So these are the steps that are required to do the setup for the work center. And that exercise is number 8, I guess. Let me just check the exercise. So the deep dive, this is exercise number 7 is maintain work center, and 6 is activity area, right? Done. We did the step number 1, define and then assign bins. And then finally we do the, all the ascending, descending, alternating, blah, blah, blah. And finally, we executed the sort SBST. All right, that's done. And before that, we did the modification to the bin and we ensure that the bin type and, the bin section, which we are using for saying that this is a special dial or, default dial to achieve the consolidation group. So we achieve that via the bin section. Then we maintain the work center. So we are done till exercise number 7. The 8th one is just nothing like a Bible or a sort of Quran. So here we just need to ensure that all our products, we're going to use some 18 products in this coming week and a half. So these products are, as I said, the suffix, you should use your products and ensure that these attributes, the one which we talked about, right? The PASI, the put away control indicator, the removal indicator, the section indicator, the bin type, alternate bin type search, bulk materials, which has a bulk indicator, and also the PTDI in determining the WPT. So these indicators need to be maintained. Most of them in the warehouse view, and few of them at the storage type view, especially the small parts and tiny parts, whereas the large parts and the bulky parts and you know the unitized goods are all you need to maintain. There are two approaches. One, you maintain them properly and finishing this exercise. The other, you maintain them on a neat basis when we do the exercise, you know, so that you will learn. I prefer the second option now, so it's up to you guys. So exercise 8 is not mandatory at this point in time. Ninth one is the pack specs, where you need to maintain the pack specs for individual products. So we have two products, the 3 and 5, which are single level HUs, and the LP7 is a two-level HU or multi-level HU. Then we need to maintain a pack specs for value-added services. The only difference between the regular pack specs compared to the value-added pack specs is each level corresponds to the activity. For example, level 1 corresponds to de-rusting, you know, removal of the rust, and level 2 may be honing, level 3 may be, you know, grinding, level 4 may be polishing. So it's not like a inner pack, outer pack, or palette. The VAS pack specs are slightly different. And then we maintain a pack specs for a reference product. For example, there are a lot of small and tiny products having the same configuration, meaning all of them are 8 each is in a carton. So it doesn't make sense to create pack specs for, let's say, 100 products. Instead, we can maintain the pack specs for one product, and all the 100 products can refer to a reference product. You know, the reference product is given in the basic data view of the MM01. So if you go to MM01, we have something called reference product. So let's take a small product, VTSP107. So I just go in a display mode. So if you go to the basic data, so here we say reference product. You know, so for this reference product, we can maintain the pack specs. If, for example, 100 products having the same configuration, we can maintain one pack specs, and all the 100 products can point to the reference material. You guys, if you have some 5 more minutes, I can complete the pack specs. Else, we can do it on Monday. It's up to you. We'll just go with the majority. You know, like if you guys have time, just raise your hand.
You can carry.
Okay. Anybody else have any questions or closing comments? Else, have a nice weekend, and you know.
Thank you for attending the session. I hope you all enjoyed it. Don't forget to like and subscribe to our channel. Also, feel free to ask your questions in the comment section below, and we will reply to them at the earliest.